Okay, so we're starting the Hyper-V class today, and for that we need two machines. And first, let's just start and add the role of Hyper-V. I want to show you, and do not, in fact, okay, let's just follow me, because if I say something more, you're gonna be, huh? Okay, what? So let me just show you first thing. Let's go and check the error. What is the error we're expecting? When we install Hyper-V now in our condition situation, what is our situation now? We have installed Windows 2012 inside VMware Workstation. If Windows 2012 was separately installed already, like independently installed, not in our laptops, I mean in our laptops we have Windows 7, right? So if it was independent, this error would not have come. But this error will come now, so let's just go to add roles and features and see this error, and then let's start the workaround. And we're gonna talk about that as well. But we, you know, always the drill. What's the drill to add the roles? So I'm just gonna go next, next, next. First three, and then where's the Hyper-V role? Oh, let me just put the. Okay, now you can see, right? So, Hyper-V here, right? Hyper-V. When you select Hyper-V, you're getting this error, right? So this is just the name of the machine, so I just ignore that. You have to add Hyper-V role in the roles list, and when you click it, it's supposed to give you an error. So this is the error that it's supposed to give, which means that Hyper-V cannot be installed. A hypervisor is already running. So what is hypervisor?
The operating system that do the
for virtualization, we use hypervisor, and there is hypervisor 1, hypervisor 2.
Yeah.
The difference. So, first of all, yeah, this error is there. Let me just talk about the difference, and then we go ahead then. So, what is hypervisor 1? There are two operating systems here. There are two physical machines, suppose, and you will be installing hypervisor 1 and 2. So, hypervisor 1 is bare metal machine, you could just install directly. So hypervisor 1. So, and hypervisor 2 will be hypervisor 2. So what's going on here? You install the hypervisor software. For example, VMware has ESXi, right? VMware has ESXi, and Microsoft has Hyper-V, and Citrix has
Zen Server.
Zen App is there for application virtualization, right? So, and Zen Desktop is, as you said, is for we have our Citrix expert here, Tamur. You can ask any question without any exaggeration, really. So, okay, this is hypervisor 1 directly installed over the hardware, talking to the hardware, and it's dedicated for virtualization, which means what? That now, this is what the only purpose of this machine would be, just to deploy all the virtual machines here, right? And keep deploying virtual machines. The only purpose is this. What is hypervisor 2? So, I will be installing an OS first, and then over the OS, I'll be installing a hypervisor, and then over the hypervisor, I'll be deploying all the virtual machines, right? So what's the difference here? What exactly is going on here? The OS, it's taking up also the memory, the processing, the hard disk, right? I don't mean by hard disk the hard disk space. Yes, hard disk space, but hard disk spaces are very huge now, easily available. What exactly it is taking from the hard disk? The read and write, IOPS, input output per second, right? Read and write speed. And we know now that hard disk is a very important factor in speed, yeah, in the performance of a software. Hard disk is a very big factor now, not now, before as well. But the thing is, if you have SSD and if you have not, if you don't have SSD, there's a big difference now, right? So all the servers in the company, they have, you know, SSDs deployed. for better performance of application. So what do you see the difference here? Hypervisor one, all memory, processing, and HDD IOPS, which is input output per second, is mostly or totally available for VMs, exactly. And here it's just that, okay, when you deploy OS and you're deploying hypervisor, this means that and that is only possible in Microsoft. Zen server, directly you can install. There is no Zen operating system and then Zen server, right? And there's no VMware operating system and then VMware hypervisor. Only Microsoft has that solution where you have an operating system and hypervisor you can deploy. This just means that what's the benefit of that? We see that there's a disadvantage. Okay, operating system is just uselessly getting all the memory as well, which we could have dedicated to virtual machines, but there's a benefit as well. What is the benefit?
There is another disadvantage. If your OS crashes
it takes the whole thing. But if suppose you have two and the live migration is available, if you have high availability, otherwise if you don't have availability, exactly you're right. It's going to take, if there's an operating system problem, your hypervisor environment is also, your virtual machines also get affected, exactly. But what's the advantage? There's actually an advantage as well for small businesses actually, small and medium size.
The management of that hypervisor.
The licensing price.
It's the same for both. Licensing for OS, yes, one extra. Other than that, virtual machine licensing there, virtual machine licensing here, same.
You are not paying for ESXi license.
No, but
ESXi is free.
Hyper-V is free.
Zen server is free, and Hyper-V also, you don't have to separately do a license for Hyper-V. Hyper-V is also free.
That's not saying that that's the advantage.
But you said
disadvantage.
No, but, okay, one advantage is exactly this. There's another advantage. Think. Okay, this is, Hyper-V is a role, right?
Okay, one advantage that in this scenario, the VMware is accessing the hardware abstraction layer through the operating
through
system.
The OS.
In that case, they are directly interacting with the hardware abstraction layer.
So there's a very small footprint of the actual hypervisor itself.
Yeah.
So VM virtual machines take benefit of that. No, I'm saying the benefit of hypervisor 2. What's the benefit of hypervisor 2? We know the drawback, but there's a benefit as well. What is that? In Microsoft context only. And the benefit is, okay, it's a role we install, right? This means it could be a multipurpose for small organizations. They cannot afford higher-end machines, or they cannot have multiple machines. So what they do? You can install Hyper-V role, add another role to that.
Another role.
File and print services, or... you can have DNS, DHCP,
okay,
domain control. It's a multi-purpose. So as well as hypervisor, you can just keep adding RAM. But main thing is that it's a role, and you can add further roles as well. You could just use as a multi-purpose machine for smaller organizations, which they really want. And VMware is going and targeting the less budgeted marketed or medium or small size organizations as well by introducing that vSAN concept there. So here, hypervisor 2, you have a role you can install, but there is another way you can install. So first of all, we install OS as a GUI. In our case right now, that's the thing we have now. We have operating system installed. On that, we're going to be now adding the role Hyper-V. And this is the GUI version. There is another way you can still install operating system. Yep. Is it type 2 or type 1?
Type 1.
So what is type 2? Is it, did we all get the opposite of that?
Yeah, hypervisor 1 is just like, the ESXi and the Zen.
No, but he has added in hypervisor 1. Already Hyper-V is under.
No, it's
hypervisor 1 is, what is the definition of hypervisor 1?
Okay, when we install a VMware machine. When we install without.
He's saying the opposite of
No, when we install without GUI, then it is hypervisor 1. If we install
no.
it as a role...
No, this is the answer of this question.
One of them is Hyper-V server that you can install on the bare metal. The other one is the Hyper-V role that
yeah.
you install on a Windows machine.
Yeah, yeah. No, but his point is different. He says, you're saying what? Hyper-V, Hypervisor 1 is actually with OS?
Yeah, Microsoft Hyper-V is type 1 hypervisor.
If it is deployed on a server core, or if it is deployed directly, if it is deployed over an operating system. So there's a let's just go to the slide here. So let me just get to that hypervisor 1 and 2. We just went ahead with that, and I just wanted there's a lot we need to cover today, but I wanted to get to that point, and I put it in the last. I hope it is there. Seriously, okay, it's not there. So let me just get it. Hey, slide over. Okay, let's go home. Yeah, let's just Google it. Guys, we started that. So if we just Google it, hypervisor 1. Type 1 and type 2. Oh, seriously, they always involve. Type 1 hypervisors are gaining popularity because building the hypervisor into the firmware is providing... Okay. Typewriters are being used mainly on client system where efficiency is critical. Seriously, bad definition. Pluralization and
Wikipedia.
So what is type 1? Native or bare metal? So hypervisor 1 or type 1, that's we're correct, right?
Yeah. Okay.
So type 1 is bare metal, that's what we were talking about. That's what we said. Maybe yeah, we're, so type 2 or hypervisor 2, as we are saying that, this is where OS is installed as well. So I thought you were saying that, no, it's the opposite of what we are talking here on the board, on the...
No, but they consider Microsoft Hyper-V as a type 1
hypervisor. Hyper-V as a type 1 hypervisor, but there's a condition here. That if you, the Hyper-V is also available separately as well. Did you know that? You can just download Hyper-V directly.
Yeah.
Hyper-V. Only
and
directly. Yeah, you can just directly download that. But your point is that it is still Microsoft is saying it. Hey, this is exactly like ESXi, but it's not. It is server core and Hyper-V combined together, and Microsoft says, hey, this is our Type 1 Hyper-V we are giving you because there's yeah. You were saying
the point is if you install Hyper-V server, it's not like a Windows machine.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
It's totally different from the server. Right?
Yeah. So, guys, what discussion is going on here? Microsoft Hypervisor. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what we're talking about, exactly. You're confirming that. Thank you. So, definitely. Yeah, so about Microsoft Hypervisor, one more thing. You can install OS operating system with GUI, which we have. But you can also install OS Server Core. And we tested that, right? Server Core, what is Server Core? We know that. And then Hyper-V. There's still another benefit here. Server Core already is a small footprint. Right? Hyper-V, you can add to the server core. So it becomes, what, type 1? But still, it's a server core. You can still add DNS, DHCP to that. It's still multi-purpose while being small, you know, having small footprint there. Very small, you know, consumption of memory, processor. So OS server core you install and Hyper-V, you can become type 1 hypervisor. And Microsoft says it is, and it you know, if OS is not eating up memory and processor, yes, it is a type 1 hypervisor. But the thing is that you can still go multi-purpose here. And when you download Hyper-V separately from a website, Then we need to just test it. Is it still multi-purpose, or we can add DNS, DHCP, or other roles as well or not? But with GUI, you can add multiple roles and Hyper-V if you're a small company or a medium size, and you cannot afford extra servers, and your virtual machine requirements are not that big. Maybe you just need 3 or 4 virtual machines. That's all. So you can just add any existing Windows 2012 Hyper-V role. You can add to that. Add more memory to the machine and then use it multi-purpose. You can also go for operating system as server core and then add Hyper-V. It's a small footprint, but it's still multi-purpose. You can still add at least DNS, DHCP, which just takes very small space as well, or very small. It's just the network or the requests it will take. But if you just add DNS or DHCP or any of the smaller role, you can still do that in so Microsoft keeps it multi-purpose, but you don't have to use the other roles. Just dedicate it for Hyper-V. And suppose you have 50 ESXi servers. With which software you handle 50, 100, 200, 1,000 ESXi servers?
vCenter.
In Microsoft, how do you handle 2,000 Hyper-V servers? System Center, Virtual Machine Manager, or SCVMM. SCVMM. That's from this, you can just handle all the, it's a separate course, it's complicated, but it has huge amount of features. And it's really gaining popularity now. And in some of the jobs, they are asking, hey, do you know SCVMM as well? Because we have Hyper-V environment, because they want to save money now. That some many of the companies do not want to keep on giving VMware huge amount of money for support and everything, when Hyper-V is also showing now stability in bigger networks as well. So, and it's really saving a lot of money to companies. So any skill on Microsoft side is also gaining support, but still VMware is a larger share in when it comes to virtualization. When it comes to application virtualization, ZenApp has the largest share in the market. When it comes to cloud, do you know who has the largest share?
Amazon
has the largest share in the market. And Microsoft is like this near to that, like very far. Amazon has huge amount of data centers. It just went cloud. So that's why now the highest paying job is Amazon Cloud Architect. Highest paid job is now in the Google is going for application. Everyone has started cloud, but who has the largest market share?
Of course, Amazon.
So that's what I was saying. But otherwise, everyone is in the market. Azure is in the market. But if you go and see who has the largest amount of data centers across the globe, and what is the percentage of those data centers between one company and another, you'll be amazed to see that Amazon has really gone very far, and now everyone has to catch up to get the that market share in the cloud. Anyway, so let's just go ahead. That was a yawn. I thought it was a question.
No.
Okay. So yawn or a question? So. Or like, sorry. So anyway, we're gonna shut down both machines, and we're going to do the workaround. I'm gonna send you the workaround now, and this is so we need to shut down the machines because we need to change the configuration file of both machines and add 3 lines of code there, and then start, and then also there is an extra step. So I'm just gonna put that there, the how to install Hyper-V inside VMware Workstation. This is the document, or this is a PDF. I hope everyone has every two. This is a document for that. So let me just send you. So sending now. Nowadays it's cohort 8, right? Sorry?
Thanks for the mail and job posting.
Welcome, you're welcome. I was receiving so much, so I thought, okay, let's do something about that. Welcome.
How many jobs in the market?
Man, there are so many I could not send. There were so many, that's why. No, but there, that group is sending for US jobs as well. So those who are citizens already, they are going to US and getting that job. Texas, and there were so many. If I will ask one, you know, email that, do you want US jobs as well? So, you know, if you want to go across the border and apply. So those are, I'm only sending Canadian jobs only, right? If anyone is citizen or in future, there are many US jobs as well. Work around for Uncle Trump. Uncle Trump coming.
Uncle Trump and Kala
Helen. They're using Punjabis, man. Okay, guys, so. Yeah, so everyone, sorry, yeah, you're saying?
No, actually, we're
this is a class, not immigration.
Immigration.
True. Let's come back.
Okay, so everyone received the email?
Yeah.
Yes, open, and please follow if you can. Otherwise, I'm doing that right now, so you can follow me as well as go the email. It's just three code. So there are two steps, actually three. First, shut down the machine. Second, go inside the folder of the machine. Third, okay, there are five steps now. Third is open the VMX file for this, which is a configuration file for this virtual machine, each virtual machine actually, and then open a notepad and add that code, save it. Then before starting, you have to make changes in the processor as well. So there are two major steps: make change in the configuration file, make change in the processor, and then start the machine, right? So I'm gonna do that now, and let us start. So I'm just shutting down the machine now and going through. So how to know where's the folder? There is an easy way as well. Otherwise, of course, you can just go to users. You can go to your username inside C drive, users, your username, then documents, then virtual machines. But anyway, I'm showing you here. So and putting it in the magnifying glass. So right-click your virtual machine. After shutting it down, right-click it. If you go to settings here, after shutting down, right-click. You go to settings here, and whenever the settings open, okay. So options, and there is the path working directory is showing here. If you just copy the whole path here in the options, right-click the machine, settings, options, the whole path is there. Just copy and put it in run or put it in Windows Explorer. And so I'm just opening the run, control V to paste the path and enter. We are entering inside the folder of first machine. Second machine, exactly the same procedure. So this is the inside of that machine. So here I need to open this .vmx file, right? If you cannot see that .vmx file, you can just try to see the detail or type of that virtual machine configuration. It will be written there, virtual machine configuration, right? Either .vmx, sometimes the extensions are not available because you did not enable that option to show extensions. So if you cannot see that, then go for virtual machine configuration, right? Exactly. From the view, you can just change that option. So in fact, if you can't see the extensions, go to view and go to this file name extensions and click that here so you can see the extensions if you're not seeing. So everyone there, .vmx, you can open. If you can open, right click and go to notepad. So right click the .vmx and open with, and there's the notepad, right? So I right click the .vmx, open with, and notepad. Every two there? Every three? So Notepad. Once Notepad is there, now there's a long line of code here. I need to go way down. Yeah, there's a background music to that. So I'm here. So at the end of this, we need to just add three lines, which is in that document, workaround document, right? So once you're there, I'm just gonna go to that document again. There it is. I need to catch those three lines. So I'm just gonna put it 100%, press okay. So this document, I'm just gonna keep going down, which I sent you in the email. I'm gonna keep going down. You need to open that document to copy that code, right? So let's just go down, and one day the code will come. Oh, I think I went down too far. Oh, that's not even that document. Okay, let me just open that El Correcto document. Double click. Oh. And .vmx is open, and then this is the code, right? So just copy paste, that's it. And do not copy paste between any available code. Let's do the most critical part now, because he's going out. Okay, so copy, and then Notepad. Where is Notepad? So at the end of the Notepad, just make sure at the end, just right click and paste, that's all. Even if there's a space, no issue, but since we're going for the formatting as well, and it might be confusing, but even if you don't do that, it's okay. As long as it's at the end of the code, we're okay. And that's the end of this lab. Oh, no, okay. So we're just going to close. So three lines added, no issue here, right? You press yes, save. Okay, second thing we need to do, I'm just gonna go back now to that virtual machine setting, virtual machine. So I'm on the setting already. This virtual machine, we already changed the code. This is for the first one, same procedure for the second one, right? So right click and settings for the same virtual machine again. And now we need to be on the processors. And there is that, you know, that BIOS option we enable for any new laptop that is where in the BIOS it's not supporting VT. So we're just supporting, or we're clicking those support options there. CPU performance and Intel VT, virtual technology, it should support virtualization.
I mean, available even without that code. But if we enable without code, it's not.
No, it's not going to work. It's not going to fool our VMware workstation. We're fooling that guy. So, okay, press OK here. The two options configured according to the document as well. These two options inside, so hardware, processor, and then these two options. Press OK and start the machine, and then try that Hyper-V role, and it should be working fine. So I'm going to start the first machine, and I'm going to go to the second machine and do the same thing again. So this will be right-click, go to settings. First, I'm going to go to the, you know, that working directory of the second machine where the VMX file for the second machine is. So I'm just going to select the whole thing here, Control C, and go to run, paste. I'm inside the folder of the second machine. If you're not able to see the extensions, again, go to view and enable or check this file name extensions. You will see all the extensions. We need to see the .vmx extension. Right click that .vmx, open with Notepad. Same drill again, and it should be on the clipboard that those three codes, if you haven't copy pasted anything else. So I'm just going to right click, I'm going to click, make sure that the cursor is here, and then paste. Anyone having issues, let me know, or let your nearest 911 know.
See you.
Very
nice. See you. You copied it.
Oh man, I did copy paste. I thought I did not. So, okay, let me grab the code again now. So that's Timbits after Timbits you're grabbing. So when it will be 200 Timbits, I will then, you know. Now, downer and there. Thank you. Okay, control C out of that. Not control C out of that. But notepad, now I'm going to paste it. This time I'm not gonna just correct the format because it's just okay. Close. So everyone, if you have done this correctly, start and check if you are able to download or start the Hyper-V. When you are able to, do not finish the wizard. We need to talk about certain points in the wizard as well. If you are able to go ahead from that error place, do not finish the wizard. Just stay there, right? Because we're gonna talk about the some options there as well in the wizard. So closing this and going to the second machine now and going to the processor and going to just checking these two options for the processor, and but it's okay.
Like we
have edited, we can add the roll number. Yep. So if the two major steps are done, just start the machine and start adding the roll. If you are gone ahead of that error, that's it. Just stop there until we go together. And this. Ding. All right. Okay.
Good to go.
Okay. So starting now for the first machine, logging in, and then I'm gonna try to go ahead and see if that error is gone. Gone. So, you know, for me especially, if I start eating samosa, it's like, oh, then you have a really. Oh, yeah, it should not be cold, so I'm just gonna pack it and, you know, silently, when nobody's watching, I'm gonna just leave with it. And throughout the week, I'm gonna start keep eating that. So, please try to finish this samosas before I could attack. Oh, what's going on here, man? Okay, applying. Okay, so I'm just going to try to add the role now. Add roles and features. Add roles and features. Now we're gonna start the wizard. One more thing, second machine, also same drill. So I'm just going to put there as well and try to log in from the second machine as well. Most of the time we'll be working on the first machine just to check the Hyper-V options first. So I'm just starting the wizard now. Hopefully that error should not come again. So going again and clicking Hyper-V and adding features. When we add features, we were getting that error, right? So click and it should not give, and good. We're good now. So let us go ahead. Lettuce, the vegetable, right? So lettuce. Next. So after adding the features, let's just go next. And there's that Ethernet card. If you're seeing two Ethernet cards, one is connected to actually internet, so don't select that, right? So also, if you don't select here, we can later select it still, what should we do? Last time we selected and we had that problem. So let's not select now. So we're just gonna go ahead. It's going to create that one virtual switch, which we need to delete anyway. So, okay, let's select it because I need to show you how to delete that as well, right? Because we're gonna miss one point, so I don't want that. So let's just select this, but if you have Ethernet 1, which is connected to internet, we don't need that, right? Yeah, so WAN, just disconnect that. I disabled it already, so that's why it's not showing here. So just select this network card connection, NIC, and then go next. So this is an option here, allow the server to send and receive live migrations of virtual machines. Now there are two options here. First of all, We're going for the features, local features of Hyper-V, and we can enable this option anytime inside the Hyper-V as well. But what it's saying is authentication protocol, excuse me, if you want to use Kerberos to remotely connect to from your workstation or whichever your machine you're logging into through the Active Directory account, if you want to connect from that remotely to your Hyper-V, and you need to use the Active Directory Kerberos authentication, then we can select the credit SSP or use Kerberos. We can use then Kerberos. And when we talk about Kerberos, what is Kerberos? One liner. But how does it work? Tickets. Kerberos equals tickets. Tickets equals Kerberos. Kerberos, oh, okay. Anyway, Wonderland is opening. So, tickets, right? And year pass and ticket. There's no year pass. What does tickets mean? How does ticketing work?
Issue a ticket, and then after that, the client who has that ticket doesn't require authentication again. So whenever he will access any network service, it is already referred to that ticket, and he is not required any further authentication.
Yep, you're right. Well, kind of. Actually, one-liner, if I ask, you're correct. And I'm sure. If you were about to ask again, sure.
If you are going to ask the interview question?
That's not it.
MCSE? Or VCP? That's a big problem.
Yeah. So, guys, Kerberos, it's so important that one of the guys in the previous cohort, as I said you before, told you that story before, that he said that, sir, I told everything we discussed about Kerberos in the interview and I got the job, and some third student told me that he said that to them, that he got the job because of whatever discussion we were doing in this class, and he didn't tell me directly, so then I went after him, where's the for the job. I got to know that you, every question came from, you know, this class was helping in your interview, so where's that food? Then he had to bring. I was like, what kind of guy are you, man? So anyway, guys, this is not just exactly for the job, but just listen to this. Oh. Hello. No, there should be. There is volume, it's not full actually, you're right. And it's not, oh, now I muted it. Oh, there's volume. Hey, you're a genius, man. Let's see how full.
Advanced concepts like.
Okay.
Delegation and so forth. Important to understand what's going on under the hood in Kerberos. So, let's dive in. So in
serious.
Any authentication situation, you really have three different parties that are involved. First is the client. Now, sometimes that's a client computer, but more frequently it's an actual user who's sitting at that computer and trying to access resources. Then there's the resource that they're trying to access. In this example, it will be some files on a file server. And there's the KDC, Key Distribution Center. Now, in an Active Directory network, that's an Active Directory domain controller. And this is the guy that really kind of brings everybody together. Interestingly, in Kerberos, there's no communication between the resource and the KDC. There doesn't need to be. The client actually takes on the majority of the processing burden in Kerberos, which kind of distributes that authentication workload across the network. But it does so in a way that's secure and trustworthy, as we're going to see. So, things kick off when the client attempts to actually log on to the network. Here's how that works. Client constructs an authenticator. Now, That's a special little package that says, here's who I claim to be, and some other information, including the date and the time. Now, those authenticators are only good for a certain period of time. That way they can't be captured and then replayed back on the network by an attacker. So, this will represent that authenticator. Now, a portion of that is unencrypted, the user's name and so forth. That way, when this gets sent off, the KDC or domain controller can see who's trying to authenticate. But a portion of it is encrypted using the user's password. So that's what this pink key will represent, and that's what this pink block will represent. But the user's password, which is known to the user, has been used as an encryption key. This is an important concept because it emphasizes the fact that Kerberos doesn't transmit your password across the network. It uses it as a shared secret. Shared secret.
Important concept. The password never travels your network, right? So this is very important. And in last class, there was one guy saying, I don't give this. I mean, I don't understand that. No way, password travels. I'm like, yeah, right. Just see the video and be quiet. Anyway, oh, it's recording. Anyway, password doesn't travel, doesn't leave the network. Otherwise, I can just go, as an employee, I can just go take a sniffing tool with me and there you go. CEO password going by, okay, got it, I'm CEO now. Cool. Anyway.
It simply means that when this thing is sent off to the domain controller can open it up and can see in clear text, okay, this is who that user claims to be. I'm going to go in my database and look up what I think their password is and see if I can use it to decrypt the authenticator. I can't. Well, then this was clearly encrypted with a password other than the one I know about, so this user isn't who they say they are. If I can decrypt it, though, then this user must be who they say they are because they've got the correct password. So from this point, I don't need that authenticator anymore. It can actually just completely go away. Instead, I'm going to create a ticket-granting ticket, or TGT. Now, I, as the domain controller, have my own encryption key that I'm going to use to encrypt a portion of this TGT. I've already gone through the laborious process of looking up this user and making sure they are who they say they are. So I'm going to save all that information in here. I'm going to encrypt it using a key that only I know. Then I'm going to transmit this whole thing back to the client. They're going to store it in a special area of memory called the Kerberos tray. Now, that's an area of memory that cannot be swapped out to disk. Always lives in memory. That way, if the computer crashes, this information hasn't been saved anywhere persistent. Okay, so now the client is logged on, they're ready to go, and they're ready to get to something on a file server. So my computer looks at my Kerberos tray and says, well, you don't have a ticket for the file server, so we're going to go back to the key distribution center, and what we're going to do is send it this ticket-granting ticket along with a request. Hey, I need a ticket for the file server. The key distribution center, the domain controller, does not have to look up my information again. It simply uses its key to decrypt the TGT that it gave me earlier. If it decrypts successfully, then it knows that this is the information it generated itself previously. Now, these ticket granting tickets are usually good for 8 hours by default, so periodically they will have to be destroyed and renewed. That way the domain controller gets an opportunity to revalidate my identity, but it doesn't have to do that every time, which saves it some effort. So the client actually does keep a copy of this in its Kerberos tray. It sent a copy off to the domain controller. The domain controller knows who I am now and can thus generate a ticket. Now here's the cool thing. Because this file server is also a domain member, the domain controller has its logon password, which it uses to encrypt this ticket. There's no communication to the file server itself. Instead, this ticket is created by the domain controller and given to the client, who stores it in the Kerberos tray. Now, for the next 8 hours, while that ticket is still good, any time the client needs to access something on that file server, all it has to do is create a copy of that ticket and send it to the file server. File server says, I have no idea who you are, I've never seen you before, so I'm going to use my password, which I know, to try and decrypt this ticket. If I'm able to do so, then this ticket must have been generated by the KDC because that's the only other person that knows my password. That tells me, the file server, that this is a legitimate ticket. So I'm going to go ahead and accept that. I'll open it up. That'll tell me your username and what groups you're a member of. And I'll use that information to decide what you're allowed to access. And every time you come back to me, Mr. Client, you're going to need to resend me a copy of this certificate. That way I, the file server, don't have to store all this garbage in memory. Because the file server is working with hundreds, potentially thousands of users. If it had to keep all of those tickets, it would be a huge pain in the neck. There's actually a command line utility you can get, or a Windows utility called CurbTray. It's in resource kits available for download on the internet. And it lets you view this Kerberos tray so you can see all of the tickets that a client has gathered. So this is how authentication works. The client goes to the KDC to get the ticket, and then it stores them and presents them to a file server. That's how the whole Kerberos protocol really works. I hope this has been informative for you, and I'd like to thank you for viewing.
Blah, blah, blah.
Wait a minute. Two questions.
Yep.
The time that the guy said that he sent the ticket to the file server and file server uses his password, it's talking about the computer account password?
Yep, computer account password. Computer also a password.
Yeah. And also, for the first time that, not the first time, the second time that client is asked to change his password or her password, how does it
So passwords are given to the client, to the users, right? So the first time, that's the only question that really pops up, that first time or any one time the password must have traveled to the domain controller somehow, or how the user knows his password. So you could just write it on the chit.
My password expires. I enter it and it asks me to change your password. I enter the new password. How is this new password will be encrypted and sent to
me? No, but password, when it's expired, unless I change it, it is not changed on the server side.
But how does the communication goes? I mean, server has to know the new password now, right?
What?
The password was changed
password
by the...
still there, unless even it is expired,
mm-hmm.
but it's a valid.
It's a valid old password through which you change.
The
communication always is through this ticket, whether you even change the password. And whatever password you change on the basis of the current password. So the encryption would be the same from the new password as well. That is coming from the old password. So the server has to be communicated still through the tickets. That the password has been changed.
Okay, so password is not sent, but password is used as an encryption.
Yeah.
The key point is, the password is not sent, but it is used as an encryption.
It's just like, if from that same password, the server will also decrypt. If it's the same password, they can encrypt and decrypt.
It is kind of MD5
So we can say kind of, but we're going to be talking about that in VPN in detail.
No, but it's...
Yeah,
yeah,
so we can also say it's through hashing, exactly, hashing also, that you put the password here and the other one, he also says that the password is being used as a shared key. Anyone knows the concept of shared key? Shared key. You know the key and I know the key.
Yeah.
We don't transfer the key.
Somehow, both know the key.
We both know the key. So that same key that I close this box and send you, that's the key you must have to open it.
Okay, so in a layman, I'm sending you the ticket, use my password which you have to open that.
Yeah.
It's a kind of simple.
So password, through password, I just closed it or encrypted that
using
communication.
Using the password, I just close it. So
and
if you have my password, open it.
Open
so
it.
Password is not transferred.
Exactly.
Got it.
But your point, actually, we need to go to TechNet and check exactly. Kerberos has huge amount of documentation. If we
my new password with the previous password.
So that makes sense, that exactly the same encryption ability is still there, which Active Directory knows. It's just that you've changed the front letters only. Background encryption is there. So MicroNugget, this is a site where some major concepts they give as free. Otherwise, CBD Nuggets is $100 per month. So And here, Gerbro's discussion is available on this very cool forum. I don't know who genius guy has this forum created. Oh, okay. I met that guy actually. He's cool, man. I met him. Anyway, so let's just go. And you can create a free account there if you want. okay, minimize that. Let's just go back. Kerberos discussion. Whenever Kerberos comes, if you haven't seen this video, you must. And before interview, and you're saying you're MCSA, and if the job description also says that most of the majority of the task is revolving around Active Directory, see this video and then go to interview, right? Without that, Kerberos will come. If you say Active Directory, you're expert, and job description revolves around Active Directory a lot, right? So Kerberos discussion will come.
Job description, if they say Active Directory Administration.
Yeah. If it is the case, whoa.
So they are, every time they are...
FISMO, I know. So, guys, let's just start FISMO instead of Hyper-V.
Yeah, you can.
This ticket is only for the access to...
8 hours.
Yeah, also you can go...
So, what is...
Utopia and...
Which two? Utopia?
No, Zootopia.
Zootopia, okay.
Zootopia.
Oh, okay.
Zootopia.
Disney. Zootopia.
Oh.
Okay, so then the new ticket has to be requested. And the communication, we already know that, encrypts that. What is TGT? Again, one-liner, quick. TGT. Which does what? No. Not in you know.
Is that the owner of this ticket? Is that particular?
So, in interview, that's the second favorite question. Okay, tell me about Kerberos. You say blah, 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 blah. And interviewer then say, okay, what is TGT? So, it's just like a day pass. So, in Wonderland, you go and get a pass for a day. And any ride, you just show the pass and you can take that ride. TGT is a day pass. TGT, you want to access the file access server or file server, printing server, you just show that TGT to. You take the TGT from the domain controller and you show it to that file server, and then file server says that, okay, I'm just going to try to, decrypt it from my password, because if it came from the domain controller, which I am part of, which I am communicating to, then I will be able to decrypt it.
Okay, but in the second step, to access the other share, so he has got the, now he has authenticated through that TGT.
Yeah.
Now, he wants to access the file server. So, from domain controller, he got the key to open that. He didn't get the password. He
got the key. Which is a request. Hey, file server, can I access you?
Yeah.
I'm the client.
So he will open
file server will decrypt it. Because, because the client and the servers, machines and the users, everyone got their passwords from the same domain controller. So encryption by the client, decryption or opening that request to see what do you want and are you our guy or not, decryption would be the same password because those passwords have been assigned by one domain controller.
Domain controller, whenever we are accessing any share, domain controller is sending that ticket logged by the source password.
Exactly.
As a key. So
exactly. And that password is also being granted by...
That. So
exactly.
So
you encryption.
Right.
Exactly.
Password
coming...
Travel.
Exactly.
On the network, but the ticket travel, the opening that ticket, we require the
bingo.
Password.
Bingo. Exactly that. What was I about to say? Okay. Forgot. So let's just go ahead, but definitely this is a question answer and discussion that really clarifies what is TGT or ticket granting ticket, right? It's a day pass for, it's an 8 hour pass that is granted by. And inside the domain controller, there's a service that does that. The name of the service is KDC, right? Center. Let's just watch the micro nugget video again. So, I always see that video. Sorry?
Full meaning of KDC.
Full meaning of KDC. So it's a key distribution center. Key distribution center. Hey, from C, you cannot say share. Shares from S. Come on. C is... Oh, chain. No, it's not. But it should not be chain. Gold chain or symbol chain. Center. Yeah. Hey, I deserve a samosa now, right? So, okay. Take a granting ticket. So, okay, guys. So let's just get back to this. Kerberos was very important, and I did not talk about it in the start because I wanted it to be mentioned somewhere, and it is coming in many other places as well as we do our labs. So Kerberos could have been discussed, but this video is on that forum, and just go there and click that video before every interview. I do that before every interview where the job description is revolving around Active Directory, because you cannot always remember that. So you just refresh your... Sorry? Where it's Micro Nugget, or is it on the forum as well? It's a very cool forum by a very cool guy,
yeah.
And I know this guy. I met him personally. I mean, like he's like wow. So this is the forum. It's like itprofcourses.boards.net. And samosas.boards.net. But anyway, this video is the main thing that you need to really. Look, so let's just go back and try to just go ahead a little for our last half an hour. So one is that use Kerberos to remotely, as a client, as a system administrator, you want to remotely access that Hyper-V to do any live motions, right? So vMotion in VMware, live motion in Hyper-V, right? Main concept, a working machine where users are connected, and that machine you're migrating, and the user have no idea, there is no performance issue, and user doesn't even know that, oh, the machine actually had been migrated from one physical server to another or virtual server to another. But the thing is that this is called live migration.
But it's not live. In real, it's not live.
Well, technically, there are different levels
yeah.
of calling it live. The thing is that if there's no downtime, it's the good live. Otherwise, there's a bad live as well.
Yeah.
There shouldn't be any downtime for the user, end user, if he is using that. So CRUD SSP is the second option where you don't need the Kerberos authentication. You can just directly access the VMware dashboard and do this live migration. We're gonna use the CRUD SSP because Kerberos, we need two or three extra steps. I'm gonna send you the document for that. So right now we're not enabling that because you know, the features we need to know now is about one Hyper-V installed. Either we have although we have two, but we for now we need to just discover the features. We're gonna be layering, just clicking it from the Hyper-V option. So we need to know there as well where that option is if we later want to use the live migrations. So I'm just gonna leave it like that and click next. These are the disks. So there's a separate the folder structure for hard disk saving or virtual disk saving, and separate folder structure for the machine configuration saving. So these are separate. In Hyper-V it's or VMware Workstation, we just now know that we just saw that it's just one folder with every file related to the machine. Here the disk is in a separate folder and virtual machine. We can
Because it's very confusing sometimes,
yep.
If you're working with the VMware.
Yeah. VMware.
You just delete that, uh-huh. And then you're finding, okay, where is the other file? I just can see the hard disk file.
This actually could be a point that the folder structure by Microsoft is separate, that if you delete something, the disks are still there, the data is still there, if the accidental deletion has occurred. A virtual machine is gone, the disks are still saved in another folder structure, right? So that's why the default location is still different. The data must be saved. You can just put that default location on SAN as well, right? So next, and finito. Let's just click restart because if it needs it, we don't want it to miss it. So while this is going on, I'm just gonna go to the second server and do the same thing. That's just next finish because we discussed what we wanted to on the first one. So I'm just gonna, on the next server, I'm just going next, add roles and features, then going next, and Hyper-V there, add features, and it accepts that. So next, finish here quickly. On the second server also, I'm clicking the Ethernet 0, next, install. So, now the first server, yep. Samosa?
While you're installing?
Ethernet 0.
Okay.
click. That's it. Nothing here. Okay. And next explanation. Man, this should be transferred. We are all left out of this conversation. Come on. Okay. That's a good one. This is, we are left out of it and we are feeling so hurt. So guys, just two people sent the screenshots for.
I didn't try.
For the time. Yeah, because it was requested,
yeah.
And I spent a couple of hours gathering those screenshots, right? So I need screenshots for the last lab, right?
I will send four labs together.
Way to go, man! Way to go!
I will send at the end all the lab together.
You will, because I'm recording that. So, God, man. Okay, so it's restarting. I should have clicked that restart there as well, because if there's a restart needed and we did not do that, it's going to just have a problemo.
While it's restarting, can you tell one thing? Because most of the why in Canada, most of the people have more camera on the front
dashboard. In the car.
I have seen a lot of accidents.
To know your version of the accident. If an accident happens.
And the time it is recording?
Yeah. And then you have to check if you want to really save it. Otherwise, just overwrite
it's approved,
it.
Like it's approved. Like
yeah.
Right, it's approved.
Oh, man. Maybe it's others' fault, but somehow he or she proves that it's your fault instead.
Like you fix
and you're like, no.
It's your fault, but maybe the fault of the other one.
Yeah.
That's a very good
thing. Yeah, it's a very good thing. Yeah. But if somebody hits from the back.
So we have
and if they don't have a dash cam, or they delete the dash cam at the same time, oh, I don't have, it's not working, sorry. So you should have a back camera as well, actually,
yeah.
Just to prove
side
that.
Camera,
yeah. Still, I don't know.
Just fall off on the roof.
Yeah,
so one camera looking above, one camera down, something went come out from the downside, yeah? From the road.
That's
the yeah. Alien attack. Okay, let's just. yeah, man. So, okay. So now, the first machine is still starting, and that dreaded option of restart we checked, and because of that, now I'm just paying for that, and it's updating all the lifetime updates. And it's not coming back, so that's why there's a second machine here, which I did not click restart. But there is a red arrow button. I mean, red flag here. You know. So let us just. Seriously. So let's just. Oh, our restart is pending. Seriously, like seriously. So I'm just going to restart the second machine as well.
Yeah.
I think it's restarting for everyone.
Yeah.
Okay, it's installing all the updates. And it's still installing the updates. So this is a break. Okay. Oh, no, well, we can just talk about the other options. So I'm just going to start the slide and or go to the slides and let's discuss about the options here. So there are many features that have been improved from 2008 to 2012, but you will find 2008 in huge amount of companies. Windows 2008 will be there. If you are you know, asked to migrate something, you need to know 2008 to migrate from, you know.
More different in 2012 and 2012 are new, which is like all the new, even in
yep.
the exam.
It's not that big difference, but there is difference, yes. R2 release and all the exams are R2 now.
Yeah.
So anyway, so we have to go for R2. But 2008 also, you know, you're migrating from, so you should at least know, and we're going to do in the domain controller migration at least, or FISMA roles, We're going to know that what is 2008 and 2003 as well. So let's just go Hyper here. Let's install Hyper-V. Yeah, we did that, blah, blah, blah. So current hardware, server consolidation. We can use this for less or centralized management, optimized resources, and very high ROI. Anyone knows what's ROI?
Return on investment.
Exactly, return on investment. Reliable, can be clustered, and sandboxing, like using labs, using it as a lab. Efficient virus scan, backup, can be done on files, on all VM files on SAN. So what is the concept of SAN? Storage Area Network. How does it work? So if we go to the diagram while it's taking forever to start the servers, and we get some time to do some other stuff. So if we have these servers here, and we have our storage area network, which is SAN, which means that lots of list of or lines of hard drives are there. Hard disks are lined up here like this. In fact, I should just be going with the picture because we have internet. So I will send you that, but right now there is no SAN because we're not using SAN. We're going to be using clustering, and in clustering we're going to be implementing SAN ourselves, the Microsoft version of SAN. But you're going to understand very nice or quickly that how those SAN really work. iSCSI SAN, we're going to work on. So this is how SAN looks like, or SAN storage looks like. You have long list of drives here, long lines of drives here. And you can just pop out any of the drive by just pressing this red button. It just pops off, just put it back. There are no drives here. These are the empty bays here. So this is how, and from these SAN storage, you can just try, get any of, these are the, anyone knows what is this? Oh, sorry. These are?
Blades.
You are taking out the whole server there, right? SAN storage, or it will have lots of drives there. What we are doing with those drives? If they just have drives, and you're from a interface in that browser-based interface, you're trying to manage those. Yeah. Very, very often for larger enterprises. All applications, whatever they install, hundreds or thousands of users are connecting to that application. SQL Server or any banking application, any hospital application, there are thousands of users connected. So the performance has to be very good. Apart from good processor, good RAM, SSD must be there. It's not only, that option, you can have this. If you go for non-SSD, the performance will be very clearly bad.
I hear it's very expensive.
It is expensive, not that expensive as it used to be, but it is still expensive on the server side. When it's the production environment servers, yes, it is more expensive than what we buy in the market for our one computer. It's for the companies, and companies are earning in millions or billions, right? So getting large companies, yes, SSDs always minimum. So they have their company policy, it has to be SSDs. So blade servers are very small. You can have, so rack servers, I can just now show like this,
yeah.
And blades are like this. So, but they are very heavy to lift, and you're just saving a lot of space. They also have their, I just showed the black.
Actually, the main difference is the modular and the normal server, not modular.
See this?
You have to put everything separate, like. Module for processor, module for memory, and then, yeah.
In English, come on.
Yeah.
No, but this is a terminology, and this is good.
Yeah.
Our picture, this is actually a server you're just taking out now. Or if you go for a rack server, this is a rack server. You can see the size. The main thing is the size of
that
the blades. The server, rack server and the blades, right?
Yeah.
The size is the main difference. Rack servers is huge, while the blades are very small. And that the main thing is, they don't take space. right? They are expensive. They use up a lot of electricity as well. They are as good as any rack server or better even, right? But they are easier to handle. The interface is a little different to manage. And
but if we have the one server and we have connected, like only for the trading system, we are using one server.
So don't use them.
With the same, so we are also saving a lot of space.
We are saving space, but no, it depends on how much servers you have. Some companies have like 3,000 or 4,000 servers, and 80,000 clients, 100,000 clients, 200,000 clients. So when they have huge amount of servers, and data center is really a big cost now, so they are just going for smaller space. Small space, they can have the same capacity, same performance. So, but it's just mainly the space is the main thing, that you don't want to support big data centers. You need smaller space. So what is SAN? We have those SAN servers, having all the disks. What do we do with those disks? So these are servers. So suppose one is our Exchange server, one is SQL server, and one is our any other server that requires a lot of maybe web server. So there's a huge amount of capacity you may need. Suppose there are 10,000 user, 14,000 mailboxes. There are 20,000 mailboxes there. So you might need here local disks. Maybe there are 12 disks or 16 disks it can take. Not more than that. Maybe maximum 20. Physically you can put 20 disks maybe. But suppose you need a lot of other space. So a lot of more space, which means that in one Exchange server, maybe you need 70 or 80 disks now. So what would you do? You would be borrowing those disks from these servers, SAN servers, SAN devices to this Exchange. Hard disk will be available, or LUNs will be available, logical unit numbers will be available there. Over the network, there are two types of network. There is fiber optic and iSCSI. iSCSI is for Ethernet, right? Ethernet cables, the cables you see now. So, and fiber optic cables, which have huge amount of bandwidth, which are very expensive. So these are the cables showing there, which are used there in fiber optic SAN or fabric network. We can also say that, but it has huge amount of bandwidth. So the thing is that if you're using fiber optic network, it's very expensive. Large companies can afford it, but the speed is very, very good. Bandwidth is huge. If you're using iSCSI, which we are going to use in our clustering lab now, so this will be, of course, the Ethernet bandwidth of Ethernet, what you have, right? Cat 6, Cat 5 cables, Cat 6E cables, they have better bandwidth. And because more and more businesses are going for this, learning the disk.
Then, it's 10 gig speed. And if we do the deep cleaning, we can
do NIC teaming, but the cable should support that, right? The bandwidth should support that. So what is our network? What are cabling? So main concept of SAN, borrowing disks from this line of disks. And you have to set up, so suppose here 16 physical disks locally are available, you can just go for 70 or 100 more disks. And when you add those disks there and you log in, so you cannot tell the difference between 16 disks and 100 disks, because it's going to appear as exactly the same as if those 100 disks are actually physically available in that server. But they are actually connected from SAN. So it's your network speed now, that how do you handle that? But the good thing about that, what's the benefit of that? Your virtual machines are running here, but your data is actually stored here. So if you lose a physical machine, your data is safe, right? And you can back up this easily, you can run antivirus on that data easily, right? And you can make it highly available. You can just have another SAN device there, and it has the same hard disks there, and you can just make it highly available. Whenever this is going down or having issues, you can just transfer that here, or maybe an exact copy. Or they are clustered, so exact copy is being made here as well, and the connectivity is just transferred to this. So its data handling is very easy when the data is somewhere else, right?
They are always clustered.
It's up to the companies. And whatever you want to cluster, but we're going to do our clustering lab as well. They're going to learn a lot about clustering. So, and talk about it. So, what's going on here now is what I was waiting. So, the SAN concept is just this, that you just borrow the disks from, the SAN network or storage area network. There's another type, NAS. What is NAS?
Network
attached. Storage. Then there is another one. DAS. Direct Attached Storage. So, NAS and DAS, you can just go to Canada Computers or any other, and just buy those disks, bunch of disks. And then they are the Ethernet cable as well, Ethernet connection connectivity as well. Just connect your home cable or your office cable, Ethernet cable to them. They're available on the network, and they have Linux-based administration. So, but it's just in the browser, you can open and just, and those disks are also RAID 1, RAID 2, RAID 1, RAID 5, RAID 10, not 2.
RAID
0 is also there, but there are, if you want to make it highly available and half of the disk you want to use, then it's RAID 1. Did we do RAIDs?
Yeah.
Did we RAID?
No. Not yet.
So in storage, we're going to do RAID 1 and on this VMware workstation. So that's going to be fun as well. Anyway.
Finishing our
in December.
So many things. So many things.
At least
May.
At least May. We have so many things.
September or December, hopefully we're going to finish that.
We have so many things.
No, we can just... We can talk about many things. So we can talk about many things, and we can do the critical ones. That's the aim of this. But critical things we have to just do it, right? Okay, Hyper-V is there. Let's just go Hyper now and open the Hyper-V. This is that administration section here. If I right-click here or go to Tools and go to Hyper-V Manager here in the tools, or we can go and open it from here as well, right click there and go Hyper-V, right? So once we open that, then we can go ahead and configure it now. Let's now configure the Hyper-V option here. So this is the end of the Hyper-V lab, and let's just go ahead with the second lab now, which is storage. Now I got your attention. Okay, so Hyper-V, it is, so yeah. Hyper-V is so in the last rows also, everyone, huh? Topic is finished already. Come on.
No,
so,
how did you access 01?
Huh?
The name of his server.
No, this is somebody else's lab. I just occupied.
Seeing from the very beginning of the class.
Yeah.
We are different servers today.
Right? Yeah.
Then,
yeah. I'm not teaching there. Come on. SAN is on big scale, very big scale, and there are many, many extra features that we're going to be talking about.
Yeah. NAS, the main thing that is a file system, it's called file sharing.
It's Kaizkazi on the SAN.
It's accessible only over the protocol of file system, like SMB and FSMB. The SAN, it is block based.
Exactly.
Which one, NAS and SAN?
NAS is a file-based storage.
So SAN is again
the block-based.
The way it is accessing, the hard disk is block.
That is a really good concept.
Very good. Thank you for that, bringing up. This is a very good interview question, and we're supposed to talk it on SAN Day. But anyway.
But it also in on the IO, it affects the speed.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Block based is just you get a lot of data.
You're also handling the storage. I don't think
storage is a separate team, man.
Because you know the one thing you told about the storage, creating putting the extra storage is, you know, if you have already big volume on the SAN, to extend that you have to take off like that. Yeah,
we can, but there are now ways that you can just extend the disk. You, if you have an unformatted, you know, storage there, you can just add it there.
Down that and it is formatted on the SAN level, and you want to extend that volume. So
there could be downtime.
Take it offline and then you want to extend that volume. Otherwise, it's not going to end.
But
people are doing what we want to do. So we are just creating one new volume.
Yeah. Yeah. No, now they don't do
maybe,
that.
Maybe.
It depends on which solution you're. What solution?
HP V2010 and
okay.
Getting out of space.
So, yeah. Or snag, yeah. Okay, guys, so this is the first feature of Hyper-V. Let's go for the second feature, which is a virtual switch. And virtual switch is very interesting. The third feature, we're going to go now. Virtual switch is done now. So nobody's listening. That's why. So oh, no. Okay, I mean, yes, that's good. That's good. Very good, yeah. It is a hard disk on SAN. It is the storage on that. No, it's just one storage that is called LUN. Right? It's a hard disk. But on the SAN day, we're going to talk about SAN. Because we're going to be doing clustering. So it has everything to do with SAN. So the, in the slide, every concept is there. Right? So let's just go ahead. That's very good, but we're going to be asking Issam a lot of questions on clustering when it comes. On clustering day, we're going to be asking. Clustering day, we're going to be asking. And this is very good, actually. You did get a, gave a very good input. So on that day, we have lots of discussion on SAN in depth, actually. So thank you for this. And let's just go ahead with the Hyper-V. And we are still not hyper yet on this topic. So what... Huh? Import? We're going to create, right? So, guys, there is that these settings on the right side here, and Hyper-V settings are there. Virtual machine, virtual switch manager is there. Virtual SAN manager is there if you want to connect this Hyper-V to the SAN, and then edit disk, inspect disk. If you go to Hyper-V settings, here, now we have all kinds of settings here. Most of it, we need to really talk about it when we are talking about live motion and as well as for a bit more in-depth. But right now, I just want to get to the main simple features and get it over with so we can just come back here and talk about other features. Once we, let's just close this and go for virtual switch manager now. There, what the network card that is showing here is our one network card here, right? So for this network card, we can just connect it to any machine or we can connect it to a virtual switch that is connected to different virtual machines. So let's just do that now. First, let's just create three virtual machines here, which will not have operating system inside. They will be just virtual machines because we need to know the features of Hyper-V. Right-click this, SAN here, SAN. Okay, right-click this Hyper-V here, which in my case, the name of the physical machine is SAN because this is a machine from another class where we did clustering, right? So one of the machine name was SAN. There. So new and then go for virtual machine here. So new virtual machine here. and then just go for next, go for finish. So client 01, and this is the path for that. We don't want to put in a separate path. So client 01 is there, then go next. Generation 1, generation 2, generation 1 was for Windows 2008 Hyper-V. If you still have that, and many companies will have that, that there's a Hyper-V. So it's backward compatibility. If you still have that Hyper-V where you want to transfer the machine for some reason, so generation 1 machine could be is for backward compatibility. Generation 2 is for supporting all the new features, secure boot, SCSI boot, and PIXI boot using a standard network adapter. Guest operating systems must be running at least 2012 or 64-bit versions of Windows 8. We're going to be talking about those features. Once a virtual machine has been created, you cannot change its generation. So this is the time, since we don't have a backward, compatibility scenario here, so we're just going to go for generation 2 just to check the features there. Next. You don't also have? Anyone? Oh, that's strange.
Maybe it is Windows 2012.
No.
In R2, that is a.
No.
It's in R2, I
see. You have Windows 2012?
Yeah.
You can see one. What?
Seriously?
Like my hair and like. No, we're supposed to have Windows 2012 R2. So, but day one. What happened on day one? Let's investigate that. Okay, so anyway, you can just get from anywhere, anyone, or I can just give you the link if you email me, or your buddy, you can just give 2012 R2, or if you have ISO, you can just give them, right? VMDK. The template machine, just go get that. So, this is generation 2, so let's just go next, and this is the startup memory. Guys, anyone has an idea, what is this? Is this the full or the final or the maximum memory we're talking about, or is this the startup, minimum memory it should have? Startup means, and then use dynamic memory. If I click that and keep this, what is the meaning of that? So is it the minimum we're talking about? If the memory of a physical machine just goes down, don't just take from this. It must have a minimum of this much memory, and then go dynamically up. And what does it say here? I think we gave our machines 2 GB total, right? Our main machines are. So how much is it saying? You can specify an amount from 32 megabyte through 856 megabyte. So 516 is the default here. Let's just, we have...
We are not starting the machine?
No. Actually, we need to at least, start for live motion because we need it to be live. So at least we started, even if our operating system does not load. If it is live and it goes and works and without any error, we're good, even if operating system was there.
Maybe 256 or
128. 512 is also okay. So 512 is okay. Let's just go, because we're going to start only one of them just to do the live motion. If we are able to get to that. So use dynamic memory for this, and the 512, click next. There's one network card showing here, and that's the physical network card for this virtual machine. It's a physical network card, right? So if we had Hyper-V on a physical network, just like ESXi you put on a physical machine, then you put virtual machines on that. So this one physical network card is not supposed to be connected to any directly to a virtual machine, right? So we need a virtual switch for that, virtual switch, right? Virtual switch will be connected to, suppose you have 10 virtual machines here. Suppose you have 10 virtual machines. So virtual switch will be connected to those 10 virtual machines. And then that virtual switch will be connected to the one physical network card, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
That happens in Hyper-V, how? VMware, how? Because he was just looking at me, he's going to go to VMware now. He's coming to VMware. And actually, he has the answer to that. No, but what is virtual switch here? What is it called in VMware?
VSS.
Standard switch, right?
Distributed switch.
So in Hyper-V, there's just one virtual switch.
Distributed switch in Hyper-V.
in SCVMM, then we go for bigger concepts there, right? And you know, in distributed switches, actually in the vCenter, not in the ESXi level, right? And it is in vCenter. So SCVMM also shows that you know
a really good concept, like
vCenter. It's not on ESXi
so it's
level.
Mm.
Yeah.
Let's start VMware today.
So there will be a comparison why VMware is better actually.
Yeah.
I'm gonna compare and you know, obviously VMware is better. But why is it better? Because of the features now I'm gonna compare. But till now it's going to go same because Microsoft is resume. So okay, so we're not gonna give this network, network adapter to one virtual machine because we're gonna connect this network adapter to a virtual switch,
you
right? Yeah.
Yes.
So next, so I'm just not giving any adapter there because we're not supposed to attach one adapter to just one machine. Next, as here it's create a virtual disk and it's VHDX. VHD was Windows 2008. Hyper-V, virtual machines had the hard disk with .vhd and vhdxs, just like Excel was XLS and XLSX now. So, DOS, DOCX now, DOC. No, but this version.
No, R2 version, I think it started in R2 version.
So, man, you're really in depth with 12v12 and R2, wow. Because when 2012 came, I just don't even touch it. I just wait for R2. Because 2008 R2 was also. They have to buy that at that time. That's very good, man. So keep giving us input, which is good actually, not without joke.
Many features, those were not available.
Yeah.
We suffered a lot because of those.
Yeah, and I don't know why companies even buy that because 2008 and R2 came, then we knew a lot of other features. So in 2012, we did not buy 2012. We just went directly, we waited for R2 and then we went directly for R2. And all the exams ultimately changed with R2. Yep.
Let's check the version together.
Oh, man.
Okay. Then, because we just use VHD, because maybe our consultant is not.
R. W. I. N. V. E. R.
Build our infrastructure manually. We build our infrastructure directly on 2012.
It's a 2012. R2 is not written.
R2
otherwise, R2 clearly written.
Thank you.
Welcome. So you have to create a template with R2, right? So it's just from the start, yeah. Okay, guys. So create a virtual disk, hard disk, yes, create this, and this is the path for that, and it's giving the size of 127 GB, and is it, okay, let's not even ask that question, because if you don't have space in the hard disk of 100 GB or 50 GB space is left, can you give this 127 GB? Is it? It is thin provisioning, or if it is dynamically increasing in size, right? So whatever you install is what it's going to occupy on the disk. So let's just keep this here, and let's go ahead. Yes, create a hard disk for us, and next, and then there's installing operating system later. We're not installing operating system in there because we are already doing nested virtualization. We are in VMware Workstation, and inside Hyper-V, and then inside Hyper-V there's virtual machines, so let's not put an operating system there. It's going to really get hyper. Click finish. So we're just creating that one virtual machine just to check the features, and we're gonna go for so one virtual machine is there. Let's check the virtual switch manager there. There is external, internal, and private. One more thing, we did not install all the updates, right? So it might just not act or behave properly now. So we will be deleting something. It might delete it after we try 3 or 4 times to do the same task. And I think that this is the case because we did not put all the updates there, latest updates. So there may be bugs here. So first thing is, what is external, internal, private? So if I go to our VMware Workstation setup and right click that and go to settings, and there is in the network card adapter, we have bridged NAT host only, right? So in VMware Workstation, it is this. In Hyper-V, it is external, internal, private, right? So what is external? Creates a virtual switch that binds to the physical network adapter, so that virtual machines can access a physical network, bridge, just like bridge, right? physical network. So external, we can just put one switch for external. Internal is creates a virtual switch that can be used by virtual machines that run on this physical computer between the virtual machines. So exactly, it is host only. Host, who's host?
The VM and
the VMs of VMware workstation here in our case, exactly, are the hosts for this machine. So it internal virtual machine communication and with the host only, right? So internal is this, and private is only between virtual machines together. So if we go external, I want to, let's just go private first. So let's just create a virtual switch for the private settings. So I'm clicking here, new virtual switch is already there, and private, and create virtual switch. So when we go to create virtual switch, so it's private switch, private SW. So we would know right away that, okay, it's a private switch. We can connect to any virtual machine there, right? So there's no option of, you know, we're not supposed to. Yeah, because it is supposed to be between the machines.
Yeah.
There's a communication between the machines only. So private network, we cannot do the VLAN ID as well. So this is, as default, we can just select that and press OK. Apply, OK. So one virtual switch created. Let's just go for next virtual switch, which is internal. And I'm just creating a second virtual switch now. Create virtual switch. For the private switch? Yeah, default, we did not change anything. We're just going for that now. First one is private switch we created. Now, so let me just show you. We first created here the private switch, right? What is private switch? Communication between the internal virtual machines only, that's all. Right? Now, what is internal? Communication between the virtual machines only and to the host. Who's the host? The Hyper-V server itself. That's it. But internal switch, whichever virtual machines are connected to an internal switch, they cannot communicate outside the Hyper-V, right? They can communicate with each other. It's just like host only in VMware Workstation, that option in host only. It's here in internal. So virtual machines can communicate with each other and with the host only, right? While, so let's just create that internal switch.
Tell us again the difference between private and internal.
Private is that virtual machines just talk to each other, that's it.
They cannot talk with the host.
Outside, no. They cannot talk with the host.
They cannot talk with the host even.
And why would we do that? In what scenario we do that? Test network, where you don't want the traffic to go out.
VPS,
exactly. What does that mean? So, you know, for others, let's talk in English, try to talk in English. No, when it's very technical or there's abbreviation required, so then I say, come on, let's talk in English now. So everyone could understand as well. So, but mostly testing environment, just like if we have child domain and it has nothing to do with the parent domain in terms of day-to-day tasks, and in terms of syncing the day-to-day, you know, domain partition information. So it's, no, they can actually transfer the files. The thing is that it's supposed to be talking to each other only.
Like,
how do you, what do you define as communication between the, you know, host and the machines? What kind of communication they can do? File transfer, right? What else? If you want just an internal network, which has nothing to do with the outside network, so it would be just a test environment where would you, you know, that if I put a DHCP, it's not going to go outside. Or any other thing that just broadcasts.
Okay, so then what is the purpose of the
internal?
Internal,
it's communicating with the host as well as outside. So if there are, you know, file transfer is the same thing, but any service in terms of internet service, or, well, I can just see internet service, that's all.
Internet service.
So any services that you can communicate with that, right? So let's test that. Let's just put it to test as well. But what it says here, creates a virtual switch that can be used by only by the virtual machines that run on this physical computer, and between the virtual machines and the physical computer. An internal virtual switch does not provide connectivity to a physical network. The only thing it does not do is connect to the physical. Let's just create that. So internal SW. So now we can have this virtual LAN identification for management operating system. So VLAN identifier specifies the virtual LAN that the management operating system will use for all network communication through this network adapter. This setting does not affect the virtual machine network. So what is virtual LAN? So suppose you already have defined virtual LAN outside through Hawaii or not Cisco at all. So I'm just kidding, man. Okay, so if outside VLANing is defined, so you can just, you know, compare it with inside, that these machines should, these machines are connected to that part of the switch, physical switch, which has a VLAN, VLAN number 3 or 2. So you can just combine this, that these virtual machines are supposed to be connecting to that part of the switch, which is connected to just accounts department, and the other part of the VLAN of the same physical switch is connecting to management department. The management department still have the machines on the same server. The accounts department have the machines on the same server as well. So you can still manage the traffic of that they're not communicating with each other.
That switch is going to be connected with that switch VLAN.
Yeah. So you should have two network cards then, physical network cards. We have one. We're going to add another network card. So if you want to add a new network card, not the hard disk, network card in ESXi, does it restart? Does it require a restart?
No.
If you want to add a hard disk, new hard disk, does it require a restart?
No.
ESXi. Network card, it does. It does. Network card, but hard disk, no. Network card, it does.
Why?
So we're talking about VM. No, why? That's a good question. Anyone has answer? No, but it's just a requirement there that it's not going to take effect until the operating system services get to know this network card by restarting it, right?
Linux.
It's Linux with lunch. Lunch and Linux.
Lunches.
Or Lunchix. Yeah, exactly. So, but definitely this is a valid question. We need to Google it. So, so anyway, it's a product requirement that I'm not going to run if you don't restart me. And I'm not going to identify this as a new network card. But hard disk, you don't have to do that, right? So it just accept all the services, detect it. Network card, they don't detect it if it is not restarted. So, but why exactly we need to just go for that? Okay, internal and VLAN ID, we can just do that. We understand that. So apply. You know, now the that's why I created the internal and private switch, because I need to now, when I create the physical external switch, it needs to get mapped or bound to the physical network card or the network card we have here. And okay, let's just create that. So where I went is external and then create new virtual switch, and then it's external SW. We have just one network card here, right? If I apply that, it says this computer may lose its network connection while the changes are applied. This may affect any network operations, blah blah blah. Press yes. And failed while adding virtual Ethernet switch connections. The reason is already bound to the Microsoft Virtual Switch Protocol. So we need to delete the default one. And deleting also is not a very straightforward procedure, although it should be a straightforward procedure. Close. Okay, you scared me now. So what happened? It worked?
Yeah.
Oh. No, come on. You're kidding me, right?
No.
Samosas? You're saying because... I don't. Definitely. Anyone else? It worked?
No, it didn't.
Everyone? Say error? Now I need to scream as well. What? Okay. No, it is what you did not do there. Or is it Windows 2012? And not R2, let's just blame everything, you know, out of the way to 2012 and R2. Wow. So it's a new feature in R2 that it will work for one guy and not work for all the other guys.
Maybe
if you don't,
not selected that option by installation.
But we all did not select that. The network card?
We did.
But you, I think when during the wizard, there was an Ethernet card option. I told, yeah, you showed me and I asked you to click that.
Selected or not?
He selected.
Yeah,
Ethernet okay. 0, he selected, but the second network card, he did not. Oh, it bound to the second network card. And second network card is the only, you know, there are two network cards now showing for you. Two?
Yes.
You connected to the second one, which you did not click at that time. So yeah, you have two network cards. We all disabled our second network card. You did not disable your second network card. So it is bound to second one now, which is okay. I mean, as long as you are your virtual switch is communicating to an outside network through a physical network card, it's okay. That's what we are about to do now, but you already did because you have two. We have just one network card. That's the difference only. So it's okay. We're going to just try to, I just want to show that if we ever have to delete the network card, let's just go with that feature as well, process as well. So this is the network card I want to delete now. And if I right click this, there's no delete option, but if I go, so select this and go down, there's that remove button here. So remove this, it's going to say, this is the end of the world if you remove this. After clicking remove, just click apply, right? And pending changes may disrupt network connectivity, blah, blah, blah. Press yes. And for some, it's going to happen the first time. It's going to remove successfully. Otherwise, it's going to give us this error. An internal error occurred, which just doesn't lead us to anything. So this means if once you fail, try again. Now this is that. So, and oh, you know what? You know what? So it was up there, but now it is actually bound to this one, but I don't want it bound this one. Oh, it was done for you? First time? So apply, if you still get that error and you go apply and press OK and come back, you know, it's still gone. I mean, although it gives error, but it is gone. Sorry, you were saying? Okay, good, very good. So if it is done for the first time for some people, it's okay.
Giving error for this one, external,
so, you know, we just go with that. If you want you know, cancel out. I cancel out from here, virtual switch manager again, and yes, I got rid of that. So the thing is that even if you get an error, click apply and go out, cancel it out from there. After apply, you get that error, just cancel out. Then come back again. You should not be finding that. I think it is still gone while it gave an error. If it is not, yeah, just do it again once more, right? So it should be gone. Okay, now, so I have that network card is not bound to anything now. So we're going to do the binding with the external switch here, right? Yeah, you're saying? No, what you said, I trust you. Yeah, sure. And guys, samosa time as well. Yep.
Yeah.
Should I remove it?
Yes.
Should I remove this?
Yeah, so click remove and apply. Yes. Even if it gives error, press OK. And oh, wow, it worked. Cool. Press OK. That's it. Now we're going to start from here again. We're going to go again to virtual.
The other one, this one, is still attached to this.
So if you go external, so if you go create virtual switch here, yeah, click that. So drop down. Yeah, there are two, right? So just attach the second one. We all have one.
I should attach it to the second one.
Yeah. So when we go come there, then we're gonna do that, right? Just wait for it. But you have to just attach to the second one because you have both of them. We all have one.
Or should I just disable the second one immediately?
That's better.
So what the thing is, which one, the one that is connected to the internet?
Yeah, that's what's connected to the internet, disable that.
You should disable that. So
then you're with us.
Okay.
And after disabling that, just delete that as well. You know how to delete, remove and apply. Okay, that's it.
Let me go to that.
Take two, man. Take two.
This is on my build or local. I think this is
Ethernet one. Yeah, that's the one.
Ethernet. So
this is able. Cancel. Cancel.
Yeah.
Okay, and then go up. Yes. Did you remove that? No, it's okay. That's what we did. We just have to go through this. Apply, okay, and wait. Yeah, okay. Press close. We all got that. And press okay. Oh, press no. Press no. And cancel out. Cancel. Yeah. Again go. Yeah, we're good. It's gone. Oh, external switch. Yeah, it's. So, yeah, drop down. You still have second one. It is still detected there. You disabled it. Maybe you need to. Oh, it's still there. What did you disable there? The internet is still there. Maybe you need to restart the machine somehow. Then it's gonna take. Understand what's going on. Yeah, it is disabled. This did not get it. Maybe you need to close this out, close the virtual machine manager, and then open that again and try that again.
There is still internet here. There's no. I'm not supposed to have internet here.
Then your network card setting is not good. So your Ethernet 0 or the first network card is internet, the second one which communicates internally, you disable that actually.
I think
second one is VMnet 12. The first one is internet. So we disabled second one. We should disable first one in your case. So yeah, cancel out from here. Yeah, just go to the network card settings and yeah, enable this, disable that. Then we're good.
My problem is this one.
This is Hyper-V. No. Don't disable that. Don't disable that. This is what we need. Disable this. And yeah, okay. You're good. But still, yeah, this is good. No. You need to disable that. Yeah.
This.
Yeah, this is the internet one, right? Disable. Now, close, and close this Hyper-V manager as well. And then open and then check. And then delete that actually. Yeah, now delete this. Remove. Apply. Yes. And one day it's gonna come. Yep. Oh, good. Okay, press okay, press okay, press. It's gone. Good. Yeah, we're good. Now we can follow.
Okay. Well, now I don't have internet here again.
Yeah, which is good. We don't need internet.
Okay. So I just need to ensure this guy is on same VMnet 12.
Yeah, second one as well. Exactly. So yeah, your first one is on internet. Second one should be on internet. Oh. Hey, it's a break. We were doing the external switch creation, so I'm just gonna go for the external switch here, and this is the most critical part of this, and now I get your attention. Anyway, so
The name.
Wow, the nice troubleshooting. So let's just go back. Oh, exactly. All right, so I'm just gonna create the external switch now. So let's just go for a create virtual switch. So if we go to the map, actually, this is just In suppose this is the server on which we have the Hyper-V role, and we have just, let me just show you in picture where we are. If I just use this as the network card, we have just one external network card for this Hyper-V, and we are connecting this external network card to the external switch here. So external switch we are creating inside, which is just a external virtual switch, vswitch or vss, we can say. Concept is same, but the thing is that this is just binding to that network card. So we're going to be adding second network card, and we're going to add a second external switch, and we're going to bind that to second network card as well. And then we're going to have, right now we have one virtual machine. We're going to create two, three, and four virtual machines more, and then three virtual machines more after that one virtual machine. Then we're going to be attaching, let me just put that, one external switch is here. So we're going to create a second external switch, bind it to the second external card, network card, and then we're going to bind two machines here to the first external switch and two machines to the second external switch. What happens is that these two virtual machines connected to this external switch are going through this physical network card. Suppose outside, if we have a physical switch here, two physical switches here, so one network card traffic is going to only this physical switch, second network card traffic is going only to this physical switch. So this means that the traffic from these virtual machines are connected to this virtual switch, and this virtual switch is connected to this physical network card, this physical network card is connected to this physical switch, right? So we are communicating internal machines successfully, or separate path is created towards the physical environment, physical switch, right? So inside whichever network card the virtual switch is connected, you have to make sure that, you know, the required virtual machines are connected to that virtual external switch. So virtual machines, external switch, physical network card, and external switch here, internal switch, virtual switch, and then external virtual switch here. Oh, I messed up the name. Okay, anyway, but you get the idea, right? That if you want to have a correct flow of traffic, correct flow, then you have to do it exactly the same that you may have configured the VSS in VMware, virtual standard switch, right? It's exactly the same concept. Even in Zen server, you do that exactly the same concept. Just interface is different, right? That's the only way you can just redirect the traffic, right? So what we are doing here now, so this is just on the map. Now I'm going to create the external switch, and we have one network card only, right? So let's just create the external switch. So extrnlsw101 and bind it to this. Oh, number, why is it showing number two? And we can have you know, the VLAN ID if it is outside the network. If there is one external switch, that physical switch, one physical switch outside that it's connected to, and there are VLANs connected there, right? So if I apply, I hope it works. Press yes, and external SW01. And there's an error, but if I keep going and press no or cancel out and go back, virtual switch, and it is not there. Okay, anyway, so again, just I should have done that, you know, press okay two times. So external SWZ, just one, I'm just changing the name now, instead of 01, just one, it's the same thing, and apply. Press yes. If it gives error, now is the time to try again, right? So press okay again, right? and apply second time, and apply third time, and keep on applying until 6 o'clock, 6:30, or until the samosas are finished. Sorry?
We already took the rest.
Come on. Yep. Oh, it's done. See? Try again, Vin. So I think this is a behavior because we did not do all the updates, Windows updates. So this might have. So it will behave this way if all the updates are not there. And I'm not putting the updates because I need space. And updates, if it keeps on coming, you know, that question? Or if we, SSDs, you know, small, bigger SSDs, much expensive. So I'll press OK, but now I need to create second virtual switch. I need to create three more virtual machines since I'm inside. So let me just create three more virtual machines quickly. Client 01, 2, 3, 4. So right click, new virtual machine. So I'm just going to quickly create now, and I'm not connecting it to anything right now. So client 02, virtual machine, next, generation 2, next. If you don't see generation, just go for 1, and next. I'm not connecting right now anything, those virtual machine to any of the network cards, because later we're going to be doing that. Next. Yes, we hard disk should be created, yes. And in later operating system, we don't need that. The only change I did is client 02, the name. No, the rest is all.
You did not connect anything.
And network card, no network card connection now, because we need to connect it later when we manage the flow of traffic, or we just follow that scenario. So it's two network machine, virtual machines now. Hey, can we clone that? Enable replication is there, start, connect.
I think when you create the checkpoint, then you can clone.
No, checkpoint is there, but I think cloning is still that you can copy that folder of VHDX and connect it to a new machine. But cloning feature is actually in SCBMM, where you can, this is a third server, third party, not third party, it's a separate independent server.
Which one is you connected to?
No, so external switch. External switch now. You select external switch, create switch, and then name it. External SW.
Yeah, it does.
And
now creating the new virtual machine.
Don't connect to anything now.
No.
None. So I'm just going for third machine, client 03. Next. Generation 2, yeah, the other change I made in the virtual machine is generation 2. So just select generation 2, and I'm not connecting it to any switch. And the hard disk, next, finito. And the fourth virtual machine, yay! Okay. So see, that was a terribly complicated task to do. So client 04, so we all deserve samosas. Next, now we have just two samosas, so if anyone has a knife, we can, you know, cut it, 24 pieces of that samosa, and just taste it. Generation 2, next, finish. Okay, so four virtual machines are there. So four virtual machines are there. Now I'm just adding second physical network card. Physical, it will be physical for this Hyper-V at least. Otherwise, for us, it's virtual network card still. But for Hyper-V, it's going to be physical. So on this virtual machine, I'm going to go for settings. That's for internet. Yeah, but yeah, you're right. And yeah, we're not going to communicate outside anyway. So second network card, we can, instead of adding, yes, you're right, exactly. Let's go for local server and then enable the second network card. And in my case, I don't have another network card available. So I'm just going to create or add another network card anyway. Oh man. So okay. So press yes and network adapter next and it's on whatever VMnet 12. So I'm just adding second network card. If you already have the internet one, if you are, it is disabled, just enable it, right? In my case, I don't have that, so I'm just gonna finito it from. Yep. So the card you disable, just enable that, right? So second network card is there for me. I hope the Hyper-V detects it and does not make me restart it. So we're gonna know now. So it appears there. Press F5. There it is. Disabled. Right click. Enable. All right. All left. That's a good one. All right. Yeah. Everybody's right. So Hyper. Let's. Where is the Hyper and V? Abik. There it is. So. Now I'm just gonna go back to the virtual switch manager and let's see if it detects the second one. So external switch 1 is connected to the first network card, so I'm just gonna create external switch 2 and do I detect 2? Oh good, so I do detect 2. So external SW2 connecting to second network card, apply, yes. No. Oh, it's already bound. So it was the first one. Instead, this one is the card that I need to connect to the. It should not be saying that it is, already bound. This means that you're using a network card that is already connected to or mapped to the virtual switch. So press yes here. And just try again. If you are unsuccessful. Oh, internal error means just keep trying again until you go hyper. So now it justifies the name Hyper-V because we are all hyper once this error comes, keeps coming again and again. So the name is perfect. It's a Microsoft product anyway. Oops, I need to edit that. I really need to edit that. They'll catch me, yeah. You're teaching Microsoft and you're blaming us. Okay, so now I have two network cards here and two physical NICs are connected to two external switches. Now we're gonna connect first two machines to the first external switch, other two machines to the second external switch. Why? Because the scenario says that. There's no technical reason for that. Okay, so right click. Right click. To make the flow correctly. So, according to this magical flow, this is, the messiest diagram of all times. You know why?
You can draw on the black.
Can I make? Yeah, on the
Yeah, it is better. Oh.
No, I'll just use.
I remember my son that
did painting. Okay, so I remind good memories. So see this bad painting here. So you know why I'm creating here? I used to create on the board. So this, and I was recording as well. So whatever is on the board, doesn't get recorded. So that's why I started here. Yeah, it should be on the video. So no, I'm a very good designer, man. Only I think that. That's the only thing. So all other things, whoa, that sucks. Okay, so what's happening here is that there are two network cards here and two physical switches here. Physical switches are these rectangulars with the different edge, and there are two physical switches in virtual switches inside as well.
So these triangles are
So I'm going to name them anyway. So, and there are these four virtual machines which we just created. In fact, I would recommend that you should try that in, you know, VMware as well.
This one is the same concept for the VMware.
It's same for whoever is, you know, giving the hypervisor. This is the only way we can, you know, make the flow separate for internal machines. So the gray lines are. So I'm just gonna start labeling them. So suppose this physical switch is for New York traffic, New York users, and this is, so blue color is for the Toronto users. In the end, you're able to see this, right? I don't have to do magnifying glass for that, right? It's okay. Okay, good. Yeah. So top one is for, these are PHYSICAL physical switch YY. It's too many samosas, that's why. YY, too many samosas. So physical switches, and these I'm labeling as virtual switches inside the machine. So, and wherever it is using the gray diagram, this is for the New York users traffic, right? So if I go for, you know, the bigger stick here or line, so these two machines are for New York users. The file servers are for New York users to access, but they are on the same physical machine which has you know, Hyper-V role installed, and all virtual machines are on the same physical server, right? So the traffic, so we're going to create an external virtual switch, and we're going to connect client 1 and 2 which we created there. These two machines are connecting to the virtual switch which is for New York users. So I'm just going to, I should be naming the external virtual switch as well, the NYV switch, New York users virtual switch, and this switch is named as Toronto or Tor V switch, right? So the traffic goes to this virtual switch, and then the network, physical network card for this Hyper-V, this physical network card, in fact, let's just put the other one. So this virtual switch is inside the Hyper-V, right? These virtual machines are there, are connecting to this external virtual switch, and this virtual switch is bound to this network card, and this network card is bound to the physical switch that is connected to the ISP connection that is, you know, going for the New York branch directly, right? So the New York users here are over the internet, over the WAN connection. They are connecting to this Hyper-V through this physical physical switch first in the branch. They connect from New York to the branch to this physical switch, and from the physical switch, this physical network card. From there, the virtual network card, and from there, the two virtual machines, which are the file servers for New York users only. And the second one, the Toronto users, there is, I think I have the same stick here. Okay, good. So this is for Toronto. So these two are the file servers for the Toronto. So those two file servers are, we have created a virtual switch for these two, and only these two machines are connected. So New York machines are not connected to the second virtual switch. And we can define at one time for one machine, one virtual switch, right? So, and these are, you know, that virtual switch is already mapped directly to the first network card. And this network card is, connection is only going to the physical switch here. Right? And this is going, this physical switch is only connected to the Toronto servers in the physical environment, right? So within one Hyper-V, if you have 10 servers, 20 servers, virtual servers, they can still be regulated from the virtual environment, separate flow of network going through the physical environment. You can attach this to the physical environment in this way that, you know, internal servers are, you know, half of them are serving the New York users and half of them are separately serving the Toronto users. So in managed environment, yep. We can have VLAN as well. If there was one switch, suppose it was just one switch instead of two switches. This is just to clarify the concept, but definitely. So we did not enable the VLAN, but we can do that. And inside the physical switch, we can create two VLANs. So suppose just remove the one switch. We just have one physical switch. Then half of the ports for New York users, half of the ports for the Toronto users. And then inside the virtual switch, just put the VLAN number there as well. Right. Okay, so this flow, everyone understands that? Question?
It's not
loud,
clear.
You're talking. Okay. Yeah. Virtual, this switch is also created inside this, yeah.
Okay. Then from there the traffic goes to the card, NFC card of the hypervisor.
Yeah.
Then hypervisor is connected to the machine. That is also a virtual machine, remember, in the VM world. These are the two NFC cards over there.
So, what are the NIC cards? These are the network cards, right? These are the physical switches, external switches, outside switches. So, this is the virtual machine. These are the internal virtual switches. These are the network cards.
Why don't we connect direct to the hypervisor? If we don't, okay, if we must need that, we can connect.
Without switch? Okay, guys, one question. Can we connect virtual machine directly to a network card, physical network card?
Yeah, we can.
Yeah, we can.
We can, but in VMware we can't?
In VMware? Can we?
Yeah, we can.
Same thing, in Zen server, it's the same concept between the two. Somebody copied somebody. So, so but it's just the separate interface, right? So we can directly map one network card. Yeah, you were saying? Okay, good point. Okay, then it's going to support directly that, definitely. Well, we have to check that, but it although we didn't have to do anything, but it was supporting that. In our environment, we cannot say that. It has to be a physical server to check that, actually, that it supports directly or not, right? So this is in the video anyway, this discussion and the diagram, but you can take the picture with me posing like this. So anyway, so this is clear, right? This is
yes.
The clearest, yeah.
But why don't we remove the virtual switches?
We remove the, so right now we just created already this, right? But now I'm explaining what we did, so. Yeah, so virtual switch is just that we can connect 10 machines to one network card.
Yeah,
one network card can only be connected to one machine at the same time, at one time. But if we connect this network card to a virtual switch can connect to multiple machines. If you connect directly one network card, it's just going to take bind to one machine only. You cannot bind the same network card to a second machine.
Then
so that's...
Then we cannot have more machines.
Exactly. More machines, they need communication as well. So connect the network card to virtual switch, then connect hundreds of machines to that virtual switch. They will all have the same connectivity, right? Ethernet cards, exactly. We cannot have hundreds of Ethernet cards there. So two network cards are handling all the virtual machine traffic, and we can separate the traffic from virtual to the physical network as well. Okay, so let's go ahead. So what we try to do, we try to see if how the virtual switches are working. Second thing we need to check is how this. Okay, one more thing in virtual switch that we did not check is that if it comes today. Oh, that's not virtual switch. Man, this magnifying glass really is confusing. Virtual switch. If we go back there, there is this area as well. MAC address range. So just like we have DHCP, there's a MAC address range as well. Because these are virtual network cards, they have to be receiving MAC addresses from somewhere, because vendors cannot create these network cards. These are virtual network cards. We can anytime delete it and just create another one, and delete and create another one. So there's that MAC address range that is given by the hypervisor. That's the same in VMware, that's the same in Zen Server. So virtual switches, as far as they're concerned, and we can just disconnect those machines anytime. So machine 3 and 4, suppose we now need them for testing. So all we need to do is what? Right-click the virtual machine settings. In fact, we did not connect those virtual machines till now to the... So first, we did not even complete the scenario. Let me just go back. I just remembered that. So these two virtual machines, so two of the virtual machines should be connected to one external virtual switch, and the two of the machines should be connected to the other external virtual switch. We did not do that. So let's just do that, and then we go ahead. So I'm just going to go back inside here. The first two virtual machines, if we select those two virtual machines, now there will be a little, you know, confusion here. Suppose there are 50 virtual machines here. I want to connect them all to the first external virtual switch. Okay, so I suppose these are 50 virtual machines. Suppose there are 100 virtual machines. Suppose main thing is more than one virtual machine. Right-click them and connect to the first virtual switch, external virtual switch. You know, the name of the switch is external. When I say external, this also means the external physical switch. So this is the virtual switch. So let's just connect these two to the first external virtual switch. So settings, then go for network adapter, then just select external switch one, right? When you click apply and press OK, it again shows you for the second virtual machine. It's a manual process. Although we're not supposed to, you know, even if you want to do it once only, it's going to do it once for just one machine. Now the second machine option has come here, right? So we have to put the same setting for the second. If there were 50 machines, that's crazy. Like 50 times it's coming. I mean, then what's the purpose of selecting all if we cannot make the change once only, and it should all the machines should get it once? Yep. Or script.
Press the setting
One pressing setting for 50.
You are not pressing setting 50 times.
Yeah.
That's the advantage, right? Still, they are coming. As in Active Directory, you select 50 users and make one change. That's only time you just make change, apply, the change goes to all 50 users, right? Here, the change has to be done one by one. That's not, you know, but in script, it is possible to. Okay, for this, now again, for the client two, I have to do the same thing now, connecting them to external switch one. Apply, okay. So now the second client, set of clients, just select these two and connect to the second external switch. Settings. And go to network adapter, external switch 2, apply, okay. Then it comes again for client 4, network adapter, external switch 2, apply, okay. So that's how we can connect, and anytime we can just connect them back to private switch. Maybe we don't want those clients to be connecting outside, or we have just added two test machines, and we can just connect them to a private switch, right? So their communication will not go outside. We can just test anything we want, any tool we want, any application we want, right? So, okay, this is done. Second thing is related to disk. So I'm just gonna go back to the slide now. So Windows 2012 full core. So the Hyper-V requirements are, it can be installed on these server core as well as Hyper-V servers can be separately installed as well, which is free. It offers two features, SLAT and DEP. So second level address translation, which giving us more direct connection between VMs and CPU. So virtual machines can directly can consume the hardware directly, easily as well. Depp is Johnny Depp. His new movie is
Double P.
Exactly. No, but it, you know, this cousin of that Depp.
Sounds
him. Okay, he's testing. You, everyone is good. Test for me, man. That everyone is working or not. So. Data, huh?
Blacksmith, the last.
Blacksmith? Yeah.
Blacksmith?
I don't know. I'm not following his movies, but I just said the name. I just said the. So. Yeah, so it's not Johnny Depp. This is data execution processing and prevents execution of malicious apps to use the processor. Yeah, yeah, whatever. Okay, let's just go ahead and processing up to 32 CPU for guest max. So everything, every capacity has been increased in 2012, which was an issue in 2008. So guest machine can get 32 CPUs, memory up to 1 terabyte for guest. Storage input output is critical. Yeah, consider VMs on different disks plus SAN, RAID, SSD, and hybrid SSD. We know that you know, when you use SAN there, then you, different settings. In storage topic, we're going to be talking about RAID 0, 1, and 5, and 10. We're going to do that as well while we are talking about the new storage features in 2012. Multiple NICs can be also provided here. Dynamic memory starts with 512, expand as needed, as well as reduce. So the concept there of memory, DRS is the concept there in VMware. Here it's if you have SCVMM, then you can then your memory can be actually handled smartly, right? If four virtual machines are there and fourth virtual machine really needs a lot of memory while the first virtual machine is not using at all and it has a spare memory, so the hypervisor will take the memory from the first virtual machine and give it to the fourth virtual machine. When it uses up, the fourth virtual machine uses up the memory, it takes it the memory back and give it back to the first virtual machine, the memory it normally had. This is called?
Ballooning.
In DRS, right? So, you know, all hypervisors are doing that now. So, memory is smartly managed. Memory plus processing and, you know.
We can add a lot of features with that, like vMotion.
There is nothing between SCCM and vCenter. vCenter is SCVMM. Okay, now I get what you're saying. SCVMM.
Yeah,
System Center has 6 or 7 products.
Yeah.
One of them is Configuration Manager, one of them is Operations Manager. SCVMM, exactly. So, okay, let's just go ahead. Smart paging helps in better startup time for VMs. So, resource metering. What is smart paging? Okay, what is paging? A part of the hard disk is used as a memory, right? So, smart paging is just, it's going to manage the virtual machines are starting or not. And guest integration. Man, you should have much more comfortable chair, right? Than this one.
No, actually, we just keep playing with my chair. Up and down.
Okay, so anyway, resource metering is that you can keep a track of how much memory is used by which virtual machine, how much processing, how much hard disk is being used by which virtual machine, right? The whole environment. And then guest operating integration is shutdown, sync, exchange. These are just taking volume snapshots. So snapshot. Exchange data, guest integration services. So if from the registry you want to read something, then what is the configuration of this virtual machine? So through SCVMM you can do that, through vCenter in VMware you can do that. But exchange data out of registry just means that retrieving data out of registry. What is registry? It's giving you the configuration of whatever software is there, whatever operating system level configuration is there, and whatever hardware is there, right?
Whatever the OS is installed, it will take out from there. It will connect to the guest. Yeah, guest, and then take out the registry from there. And we can see through SD.
So data from registry just means collecting information for that machine for OS and applications. That's all. Retrieving information, right?
So instead of logging to, let's say we have 100 virtual machines. So instead of logging to that, if we enable that feature, we will have a dashboard, like we will know that what operating system is this. Which
dashboard is available for SCVMM as well as Operations Manager also does that. SCOM also does that. SCVMM and Operations Manager. Okay, guys. So let's just go ahead. This is VHD 2 terabyte maximum. So your test is coming this week. So expect a document from me. And today, it was supposed to be... It is going on right now, test. And thank you very much. You're all doing... No. And we are talking about. So I cannot record it that way. So yes, we are just talking about, and this is not day 8 or 7 where we were supposed to take test video. Okay, anyway, so expect the document from me, and during this week, please do the test before deadline, and please do not ask me to extend that. It's okay to send after the deadline. It's just that you're going to lose significantly marks, right? If deadline is not met, after that, submit it whenever you want. After deadline, at once the marks will drop down. It's not going to be zero, but every second some marks are going. Every second some marks you're losing. Per second, per millisecond, per microsecond, you're losing, you know, lots of marks. So lost in Linux? Oh, okay.
No, Linux is got 50 out of 50. I don't know how.
Okay.
Hey,
that guy here who's absent today is Linux guy, you know?
Yeah, he finished in half an hour.
And you were sitting with him?
No, he finished in half an hour.
Okay.
I finished for
an hour. Oh, okay. Okay, so VHD, so this, you're going to receive an email, and as soon as you receive the email, just start the test. And specific screenshots for specific areas only, and the names and IP addresses will be changed. So this means your machines will be new now. Or good luck changing your naming and IP on old machines. Anyway, so the VHD used to have 2 terabyte of maximum capacity. VHD X now has 64 terabyte of capacity for guest machines. They're more resilient. There's a new operating system in 2012. R2. There is a new, not operating system, the file system. There is an operating system.
Yes.
Because I did not eat this last samosa, that's why. Okay. File system. That is REFS. Resilient file system. After NTFS, there's REFS. The specialty, many, they say, you know, it supports everything big, partitions big, number of partitions a lot, and bigger size in hard disk. But also that if you lose or the disk crashes, the recovery chances are better, or losing most of the files chances are very less now. So we should try with our actual data at home, put it on REFS and then crash it, right? And let me know. Thank you.
No, but sir, it's not supporting the RAID.
You sure?
Yeah, I think there is.
We're gonna do that.
Check it, maybe. I'm wrong, but what I have read is.
You need another samosa. Yeah, you were saying?
Yeah, you can format the hard disk
REFS. Yeah, so format the hard disk in REFS? Just. So we're gonna create a hard disk. We're gonna just put REFS on that, right? We're gonna test that. But yes, you should. You should be able to. Okay, so more resilient. Okay, modify VHD, added virtual disk, differencing drives. What is differencing drive? The concept of differencing drive and especially the pass-through disk. Sorry? It says next slide, yeah, that. So I should have read that slide before. Differencing disk, it's coming. The only, and snapshots is actually called something else here. It's not called snapshot here.
Checkpoints.
So, differencing disk, what's the concept? Concept is that the first disk, system volume, suppose C drive, you only have that. You add the second disk and you add with the wizard of adding it as a differencing disk. So what happens is that whatever you install from now on will be installed on the second one instead of the first one. And the purpose is to save the disk space, you know, and as well as whatever new is installed to save the corruption from that. The main thing is that the system volume is then spared from all the new installation, and the differencing disk takes all the installation. And it's cold for me, or just or everyone is feeling cold now?
No, I think they changed it
because we plus 15. That's why we prepared today for plus 15, but it's no longer okay. So anyway, yeah, maybe it's the samosas. You know, Hyper-V settings, network virtualization. We just did that external. Sorry. We're going to go that, and we're going to do that lab.
Can you just explain, you're talking about virtual disk or physical disk?
Virtual disk, of course.
The virtual disk you have created,
created
a VM with two disks. Mm-hmm. One is we are using for system 100 GB. Other is again 100 GB. And we are
No. So the thing is, if you, suppose you installed an operating system on the first disk, and you, in fact, that's the only disk you have.
Yes.
Second disk, if you're adding the second disk, where are you all going, man? Everyone is like, so it's a psychological effect now. I said it's cold now. Oh, now.
Butterfly effect.
Butterfly. It feels cold. Man, it's like, he's pulling his zipper all back. Now you should start trembling as well. It fixes. This side is more cold, and this side is, you know, hot. So, okay. The difference in disk is, if you have one disk, and when you're adding the second one, you have to go through the wizard of differencing disk. If you just add the second disk, it's okay. I mean, then, when you install the software, it's not going to automatically be redirected to the second disk. Unless you go through the differencing disk wizard and add that way.
No, it is inside the OS or on the hypervisor?
On the hypervisor.
On the hypervisor.
Oh,
when we
you really are going. Okay. Huh? Okay, sorry. On the hypervisor is the feature. No, I'm going to show you that. So I'm going to show you the wizard at least for differencing disk. So it's there in the, you know.
It will take care, it will add the disk to that VM. It's going to be
Yeah.
inside the VM.
Mm-hmm.
But this can take care of how the rest of the thing will be managed.
So once you add the second disk through the wizard of differencing disk, in the wizard it asks, where is the parent disk? So parent disk, you can just point out this one is the parent disk. And then next let's finish. Then when you start the operating system and start installing something. So try this. It should be going to the second disk, the installation by default. So it's not, what is the purpose of differencing disk? What is the purpose of differencing disk? To save the space of the system volume.
So it means creating a new program program file folder or any, if we even user are saving the data, they will create the document and setting folder.
It should be going there.
Okay.
Should be going there. Okay. Pass through disk, exactly the same concept there in VMware, but I need you to give me that name of that, you know, what that feature is called in VMware. But here, what is the pass through disk? Yeah, kind of that, but it's not the exact name. Differencing. See this? Sorry. Raw disk mapping. RDM.
RDM.
Already there, man. Okay. So differencing this, as we were saying, this is the concept. You can go new clear hard disk. Select the VHDX. Go and check the differencing option there. And then it's going to ask, specify name and location. Then it goes for specify the virtual disk that you want to use as a parent for the new differencing disk, right? And okay, that was just the, 4 or 5 screens for wizard, and then you add the new disk. Pass-through disk, the main concept that if an application is very heavy and it's using a lot of IOPS, input output per second, for the hard disk, it's reading and write so fast, and users say the performance is very bad. it's freezing out, or when you double click something, it's opening slow. So you decide as a system administrator that you're going to add a pass-through disk. What does that mean? The application will have direct access to the physical disk, or which is locally available in that Hyper-V. The application before was using a VHDX, which is a virtual disk, which is maybe placed on the SAN, right? So over the network, performance already low, and you install SQL Server there, or you install Exchange Server there. Now the mailbox role especially. So now the read and write is so high, and maybe there are mailboxes, hundreds or thousands of mailboxes are there, and you put it on virtualization, and you know, you did not take the all the performance so testing of that machine. So once the performance is bad, you can give that specific application direct access to a physical disk that is available in that operating system. But what do you lose here? You get performance, but you, if the machine goes down, your data is, whatever data was there is at risk. But you're giving an application on a virtual machine direct access to the local disk, right? So this is here, this messy diagram. Oh, that was a good one. So if you add a physical disk here inside the machine, and not, you're not using SAN for that, with SAN over the network, you're using that disk, right? So physical disk here, and the application is also here, SQL Server. So application is installed in this virtual machine. Application is installed on this virtual machine, and the physical disk is here. So you can just give access for this application in this virtual machine directly to this physical disk that you added to this Hyper-V server, instead of the application saving its data over the network to the SAN disk. You're giving access to the local disk. Local disk always has better speeds than the SAN disk, right?
Direct, you're talking about direct attached storage.
Local.
Local
storage.
Local storage
on the server itself. Server itself.
But then sometimes if you
speed
have
is good.
Good SAN.
The best speed you can get is from local storage.
It
cannot best.
Be a loop.
It could. So there are other concepts, but this concept really talks about local storage. In
yes.
fact, let's just do this. I'm going to show you now how to do this. So let's just go there and go for VMware workstation. So first, we need to add an extra disk, empty disk, on the physical Hyper-V machine. In our case, in our Hyper-V machine, we're going to be adding another disk. For inside virtual machines, it will be a physical disk added for them, right? So outside, for the pass-through disk, I'm just going to right-click that that first VMware workstation machine, right-click this, and add another hard disk here. And hard disk is there. Let me just put it on. Hard disk adding to the first one, next. I'm just not doing any changes here. Next, finish. That's it. I don't need to do any changes here. 60 gigs hard disk added here. Oh, there's a lot of there. Okay, the last one. But the thing is, I'm not going to format that hard disk. If the hard disk is unformatted, it can be added to any, suppose you want to extend a disk, an already available disk. If you have a unformatted disk, you can add the capacity of that disk to extend an already used disk. You can extend the capacity of a used disk if you have a already unformatted disk available, right? So the disk is there, is it? What's the proof it's there? So if I go back to my operating system where Hyper-V is installed, if I go to file and storage, go to disks. That's the old way of doing this. Disk MGMT, if you go there, that's old way, means that on Windows 2008, that was the only way. In Windows 2012, we have that way from computer management you go to disk management or just disk MGMT, as you said, exactly. We can do this, or we can do this way as well. In the storage topic, we're going to be doing old way and new way both. So offline is, well, this disk is offline. Let's not do anything else. Just keep it offline here now. We can just see it from tools. The second way to see it from tools, computer management. And exactly as you were saying, disk management. In my case, I have added a lot of disks here. Just ignore that. If I go way down, there is that unused disk here, unknown, and this, right? So disk management way, and this way is showing offline right now. So I'll just keep it that way. I'm going to go back to my Hyper-V and one of the virtual machines. Suppose client one needs, client one has that SQL server that needs direct access to a local storage, nothing attached, local storage, right? So right click that client machine, settings, and then if I go to the hard disk section here, so cancel out this client machine, right? Okay, guys, one more thing. I need to show this. I should have shown that before doing this. So on the second server, I can show that. Or I need to show that first. Everyone has done that, or I can just tell it because it's going to take more time now. Too late. Anyway, so I'm just talking to myself right now. Okay, so hardware. If you had not added an unformatted disk, this option here would be grayed out. If you have an unformatted disk added, only then this option is usable. I wanted to show the grayed out option on the second machine, but then I have to create a client and then I have to show that. The only thing I wanted to show was it's you cannot even use it if all the disks locally available are formatted. It's only going to pop up here and let you use this option. Unformatted. Yeah. We just added the disk. We did not even put it online. We did not even initialize the disk, and we did not certainly format that.
Here.
Right. So then it's going to show here.
We check another VM. It should be faded out.
Now you've used it, so it should fade out now for the other ones, because we have mapped this virtual machine to this disk now.
So, but you have not added any other disk. You are just mapping. You are taking the properties of another disk, and instead of using that disk, you are using this disk. So we can add the new disk first.
No. So this disk is only showing in the physical disk because it is a physical, it's not even a virtual disk, it's not a VHDX disk. And it already has its own VHDX disk.
Okay. So let's say we have added one disk. We have installed the operating system onto that disk. Now we want to add a physical disk. So we cannot select, uncheck that and check that.
From there, no.
Add a hardware.
We can do that. But we can do that, for that will be the VHDX way of doing it. You're still adding a virtual disk this way. The physical disk access only comes for a virtual machine inside Hyper-V. Direct access to a physical disk can only come this way.
So it means
that way that you're adding VHDX.
So that disk will be intact.
Because operating system is there.
Okay, let's say I'm adding it, so it should show the two disks now.
Yeah. It should show, and it should, you just format it from inside. No, where are you seeing that? Now you need to turn on the client machine, put an operating system there, and then see that.
No, now instead of that, you have selected that.
Apply. Okay.
Yeah, so it has this.
Now we have access to that. Yes, what you're saying, let us see that.
Yeah, it's only that disk now. Physical disk.
Physical disk, yeah, you're right. Physical disk, virtual disk is not there. Definitely, you're right. We can still add. So this machine has full access to the physical disk. But
now
this
we
is
wanna add, so we can just
now you can install operating system there. Now you can install. When you install, this is installing on the physical disk itself.
Okay, can you just go to the virtual disk?
Yeah. Where?
And select browse. No, not new browse.
We can add the new as well.
Yeah. No. Apply.
Yeah, it applies and gets that, but then it is unselected. You cannot use that then.
Can you go browse?
What do you mean?
So
I went browse.
Only
one disk.
The property of that virtual.
So, if I say that you want to do that, SQL Server is not performing well, so go and check this option, create a new machine, add this disk, and then install operating system, install then the SQL Server. Now you have all the physical disks to yourself, right? So pass-through disk is giving direct access for a virtual machine to the physical disk. Differencing disk is adding a second disk to install, to save space and to save the parent disk from corruption. Differencing disk, right?
It will already built up SQL Server client 1.vsdx will come to a
you can so if it is doing this, I think it's this new machine. I didn't test that myself.
Even I haven't tested.
Yeah. So we should test that. Actually, we should test. I can just install operating system now.
On which the SQL Server is already installed. We are adding a pass-through disk just to improve the local virtual machine.
Pass-through disk, either this or that, it's appearing this way, right? I need to test that myself as well. Because it's nested virtualization, if I start this, then I can only do this, nothing else. Because it's going to take up my whatever remaining memory is left, right? But this should be put to test because there are many questions and we should put to test everything, right? So good luck doing that and let me know the results. Okay, yeah, like how to add the disk, that's what the course covers. But definitely in production environment, we can't say, hey boss, that's what the course covers, sorry. No, we should test it ourselves, right? And go through to the till the end. So in our case, we have very less time. So let's go to the next topic. And the next topic is, so definitely there are many questions for every feature we're going to be discussing, many questions. And if you go with the Microsoft official curriculum, they just even don't reach this part, or they reach this part and they show just the server side configuration. Only we are doing the client side testing now, right? That, oh, does it really work? Microsoft doesn't care in the MOC, Microsoft official curriculum, that does it work on the client side or not. Go test yourself. Or maybe in some courses, in some labs, it goes to the client side. In some labs, it's just server side setting. Clustering, go see the clustering of my MOIC. And what we are doing, going to do clustering, there's a, you know, I did that as well as then I had to do my way, where we are testing the whole thing. So anyway, let's just go ahead now and there, what's left here? Oh, what's right here? So pass-through disk, we have passed through the pass-through disk and okay. And now there is that command that we needed to know. Yeah, we did that. No, that was the wrong way. This is just to add an extra disk. Instead, we are using physical disk here.
So you're gonna cover, when you're covering the clustering, you're again gonna cover the Hyper-V cluster?
No, I'm just gonna cover clustering, that's all, with the file server. So we're gonna build a cluster and put there anything. We can put Hyper-V virtual machine, or we can put here, you know, clustering.
I have experience, like when you're treating it, even cluster, then you just need to add the role. Like you have created a new VM, so you add to that.
There are like 9 or 10 roles only you can add.
Yeah.
So one of them is virtual machine as well. Virtual machine role.
Right.
So when we are doing cluster, we're going to see everything, right? So
we're going to cover everything, like.
We're going to see everything.
Heartbeat and.
That's the basic of Hyper-V clustering, man. Don't worry, clustering, you can just read all whatever's on the internet, then come to the class. Then you can compare what we are covering, what we are not covering. But we're going to cover what we should cover according to the job interview, not according to the book. Book is just at after 5% done. We're going to go at least, you know, 80% of that. So managing virtual machine here. Virtual machine movement and SCVMM. Okay, let's just ignore that SCVMM. this is just
it's not actually real thing.
It's not part of the. If we start doing that, then this rest of the course, rest of the days left, or we can just do that, right? So virtual machine manager perform live migration, perform quick migration, storage migration, oh seriously, configuring virtual machine, network health protection, configure drain on shutdown, import, export, and copy VMs, migrate from other platforms, P2V. Anyone has done P2V or V2V?
No.
What is that?
Physical to virtual.
Have you done?
Purpose?
Yeah. It works
perfectly.
Yeah.
In VM? Yeah.
And
you've done that?
You haven't done V2P?
V2V?
V2P.
That's a good one.
No,
this should be there.
Yeah, should
we
be.
Didn't do that.
But
and
even,
no.
Even there,
do that. You can migrate
So that's V2V. He's saying V2P. Again, back. So you tested, you migrated something, and then you realized it's so bad performance. No, I want to go back to physical server. So
if you
the Acronis Live CD can support this VMDK and also VMX to restore an image to a
physical machine. Nice. It should be there. It should be. Virtual
so
machine to back to physical machine.
See, if you have some software,
there are many scenarios.
Extra graphical capability.
Yeah.
And you are unable to provide that through that hypervisor. So you can move back. Like it's not a.
Yeah, it is a scenario. It is.
Yeah.
I heard that scenario before. Yep. Question or yawning?
Yeah, the universal restore. That is happening. Yeah. You can restore.
Back to.
That's
it. Yeah, it should be there. Should be there, definitely. Oh, okay. Cool. So, understanding virtual machine movement. So, understanding virtual machine movement for a server administrator, virtual machines are one of the best tools to use for providing functionality. Yeah. Let's not talk the basics. Maybe there's not basic. With relative speed and ease, you can deliver additional applications as soon as they are needed, rather than waiting for the purchase of new hardware. Yeah, that's virtualization. Okay, so understanding virtual machine movement, live migration, quick migration, storage migration. So there's one crazy concept as well. You don't need a storage anywhere. The local storage, just use that and migrate the machine. So the process of moving an entire VM or parts of a VM to another physical server without a cluster. So that's, again, without a cluster. This is without cluster, not SAN we're talking about. So quick migration, the process of moving an entire VM or parts of VM to another physical server using a cluster, if you have cluster, then storage migration, the process of moving the storage of a VM from one physical server to another without a cluster. It's not talking about still SAN or the storage. Understanding live migration allows you to move the entire VM or its storage from one physical host to another without interrupting your users. It has to be live. This process is sometimes referred to as shared nothing migration. In Microsoft now they're saying shared nothing because the storage is mirrored over the network to the destination server while the VM continues to run and provide network services. So definitely, did you do the vMotion there? Or talked about, or you're gonna come there, right? And so it's just that either you can move the virtual machine. Okay, when you move virtual machine, what are you moving there? So
resources,
whatever is the memory, the configuration of the virtual machine.
Live storage, we have shared storage.
Okay, there are two channels now. Sorry, huh? Yeah. Okay. Okay, he's saying you saying him. So you can start both again. So yeah, please.
The live migration you can do when you have defined the shared storage. There is
shared storage. Exactly.
Without shared storage, we cannot do live migration.
The thing is that that storage is accessible over the network to the second server, right? That's the main point of storage.
For that purpose, from the beginning, it's not like the concept. Okay, you have one server and you have another server. One server, all of a sudden, is giving problem. You get that VM and put it to another server. It's not like from the beginning you have put the.
Of course. Here it's a little change concept. No, again, I'm saying that machine storage, virtual machine running here, the storage or the VMDK file, VMDK is for VMware, right? Here we call it VHDX. The VHDX file the VHS file of this virtual machine here. Suppose this is the virtual machine here, and the virtual VHDX file is there, which is the hard disk file. This hard disk file is accessible over the network by this Hyper-V. So suppose this disk is actually, and the, you know, in a VMware environment, of course, there's a storage network, either SAN or network attached. So this is the storage where you actually put the virtual machine's hard disk. So it is connected. This virtual machine has its hard disk here because it's over the network. So the second physical server also can access from here the hard disk. The only thing is that the virtual machine gets migrated here, and the connectivity to this disk, which was here, is also maintained then here. And this virtual machine just migrates here with no downtime for the users, because when it was here, it has connected to this hard disk, its hard disk, and when it was here, it has connected to this hard disk, right?
If you take out this fan without fan, okay, how are you gonna do the line migration without user?
So if you have the hard disk, this one here, and this server is not down.
Yeah, it's not down.
So you're just migrating it for some reason.
Yeah.
So if this shared folder is here, suppose that's the case, and this is a shared folder, right? So
okay.
This, it's
so
over the network, it's accessible,
but without
it's a simple
folder,
shared folder thing.
Yeah, you cannot do anything. I thought
it has to be shared. Yeah,
you have to share the file.
As long as the other machine can see it, the storage, and access it, and make read and write, which is like you can put that shared permission as read and write. That's it. If it can make read and write,
vSAN or the local storage of that server, that doesn't matter.
What is vSAN? What is virtual SAN? It uses the local storage of the servers. Yeah.
Because in this hyper-V scenario, you can create two types: hyper-V cluster.
Yeah, there is shared nothing, and there's another one.
Yeah. There is no shared storage in this.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, goodbye everyone. What happened?
No problem.
Yeah, there's still discussion going on. Everyone is okay. These two guys are just talking, nothing related to us. Yeah. So yeah, you were saying. So there are two types of migration. Cluster? Yeah.
One is just utilizing Hyper-V server cluster in nature, and in this case there is no shared storage. Then you can migrate the machine from one Hyper-V to another.
Yeah, that's
even
what.
Even though they are not residing with the same.
Exactly.
And so if they are utilizing the Windows cluster, and then you run Hyper-V on the top, or enable Hyper-V features on top of that, then you need the shared storage.
Yeah, in clustering you need shared storage, right?
No, but how
in order to create a cluster, you need shared storage.
Hyper-V cluster is using the window clustering feature to provide the high availability and these features. So that need.
Yeah. So oh,
no.
Thank you. Oh, you were taking the other side. You just broke my heart now. Okay. Anyway. So no, we'll talk about clustering when the clustering time comes.
We're talking about Hyper-V cluster.
So
Hyper-V, when we are creating the Hyper-V cluster, we haven't seen any option here.
No, we're going to, when we deploy clustering, we're going to talk about that.
So
although I didn't plan to do that.
Discovering under Windows cluster.
Yeah.
Yeah. But he's saying that Hyper-V.
No, Hyper-V, when using cluster, we can also say Hyper-V cluster.
Okay.
So, right?
Okay. One of the hosts had got problem.
Mm-hmm.
VM are moving here and there. They are coming to one server, trying to restart. No, fail. Again, going to another server.
Oh, man.
They went in the loop.
Oh.
Like,
We're gonna definitely discuss that for the class. Yeah, sure. So okay, let's just go ahead now. Live migration to Performa LM or live migration. Follow these four steps. Configure LM prerequisites. Configure LM security. Constraint delegation if needed. If you wanna use the Kerberos, configure the source and destination computers for LM, move a running virtual machine or VM storage. But of course, these are steps we're going to. So to support LM, you need two or more 2012 R2 servers with Hyper-V roles. Use processors from the same manufacturer. This is the same for vMotion as well. You need to use the same family of processor. If one physical machine has AMD and the second physical machine has Intel, you cannot just do live migration there.
Yeah.
All hosts must support hardware virtualization, belong to the same Active Directory domain. Okay, this is something we need to take into consideration. It should be the same Active Directory domain to which the live vMotion can go. Live vMotion. Wow. So the VMs must be configured to use either virtual hard disk or, okay, prerequisites are very simple so far. Use of a private network dedicated to LM traffic is highly recommended. We can have a heartbeat separate network card, you know, two network cards here, two network cards there. Half of the class is gone anyway. So, and then use of a, and then membership is one of the following groups. Okay, we already have domain admins. So, should we?
I think so.
Not that important, man.
This
is the only important thing.
Yeah.
No, we have to run Hyper-V first, right?
Yeah.
So that's why we understood the vSwitch.
Should we install some operating system in the client so that we prepare for the next class to use it?
Exactly. And I was going there, actually. Hey, we're talking about this, and I want to start the storage topic now, actually. And because there are so many virtual disk and things are coming, so and I wanted to put this on the second way, but already you started that question, so thank you for taking this from my mind or grabbing this from my mind. So this is the end of live motion, and okay, now so this is just motion, right? And it's live, you're moving, right? So anyway. So move the VMs data to a single location. This is simplest. Move VMs data by selecting where to move this atoms. So guys, yes, this is a good idea, because if we start now, it's already, you can see, very night, and we have to go home at night. I mean, it's dark outside, you know. So okay.
Tomorrow is the daylight saving again.
Daylight saving, 1 hour will moving. So we need to go home before that, before the it strikes. I mean, something could happen. I mean, our computers could go down or something. Full moon. And tonight will be full moon as well. So if anyone turns into a, that. So so before that, we need to reach home now. So guys, okay, let's just keep the live vMotion. Live vMotion. What am I mixing that for? It's live motion. And vMotion is for VMware. So live vMotion is Microsoft, and we have VMware workstation, that's why. So since everyone is in the mood of leaving and going, so we're gonna
like last 12 hour, 24 hour is going on.
No.
Class,
really?
Then in the morning, Linus class. Last night we had
ITSM
class.
What?
So
every Saturday you have last night class, right?
No.
What's so
night,
special this?
Last night was butter chicken.
Butter chicken. Okay, so guys, we're going to do the, just like we put the, you know, that ADK lab on the next week and next week and next week. So now we're putting this vMotion. Just call it vMotion. So motion. That. Let's not go to any other type of motion, right? So, oh man, I knew you would say that.
Say emotion.
Yeah, emotion. Oh, okay. Oh, resuming. Okay, I need to really cut this video a lot.